It's 7:03. I'm going to call the meeting to order. So this is the June 10th Conservation Commission meeting. The first item on our agenda is the notice of intent for 306 Main Street. Chuck, should I read the...
What time is it scheduled for?
7.
I don't think you should, because...
It's continued.
You were noted that it was continued.
So if anybody is here for 306 Main Street, that's continued. Until the next meeting.
We typically read and introduce ourselves even as it's continued. I think it's silly, but I think we do that.
All right, then let's not, since it's silly. It happens way too much during the meeting anyways.
Any objections?
No.
Okay. All right, here we go. So if anybody's here for 306 Main Street, site development of Pizza World, that is continued until the next meeting, which is June...
24.
24. Okay. Okay, so we will not be discussing that tonight. Next item, we have a notice of intent. Okay, so, oh, sorry, it's not 7:10 yet. Okay, so Chuck, let's get to some old new business then.
Can we do the certificate of compliance?
Why don't, yeah, what about this? There's a certificate of compliance for 7 Indiana Avenue. I know that Mr. Mon and Ms. Longley went to a site visit.
Yep.
So, your findings and...
Looked like all the work was completed in the order intended. There was no disruption, no unstable soils.
Okay.
They didn't do the sidewalks on the side of the house and said they wouldn't be doing that, but looks good.
And they removed the two sheds. They weren't there.
Okay.
And also noted that point of interest for our information, they had a small, innocuous picket fence on the backyard between the manicured yard and the resource area.
Yes.
And that wetland, there was no long ways, no trash. It looked a lot better. I don't know if it's just because of the fence, but
I think
we should encourage fences around the park. At least in that case, it was good.
So even though it was a short fence, it provided some protection. Okay. Is there a motion to issue a certificate of compliance?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, opposed? None? Chuck, you have that?
I have that.
Wonderful. Okay, we'll circulate that.
Is there any easy ones?
Yeah, that's an easy one.
How about the determination for 16 Joseph?
Well, that's a timed item, isn't it?
No.
Oh, it's not. Sign that off, sure.
Yeah.
That can happen.
I didn't get the negative determination in my packet. Do you have it drafted?
Yeah, we don't usually send anything out for RDAs.
For an RDA, so we should just vote on that one.
I think we already voted on it.
Yeah, I think
okay.
I was just supposed to prepare it.
Okay, and we'll just sign it.
Minor plan change can be discussed as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Good evening, welcome everybody. Before we get to the next item of business, if you haven't already, I saw a lot of people signing in. Please do sign it at the little shelf at the entrance. Yeah, there's a determination, a negative determination from Joseph Way, 16 Joseph Way. Okay. Yeah, what else can we do?
Minor plan change, stormwater general permit. All they're going to do is remove correct me if I'm wrong, remove any work within the resource area.
That's right.
From the permit, that's it. And remove any language that says work within the resource area.
Yeah, and Jamie, you had a comment, you wanted to know if George had.
No, that's Sturgis.
Was that Sturgis? Okay.
No, yeah, this is the townwide permit.
This is, yeah, gotcha. I wasn't sure if it was that or not. Okay. So, motion to approve the minor plan change.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Let me ask a question.
Okay.
We already issued the order of conditions, so what exactly are we doing now?
The DEP.
Modifying the order of conditions?
Because of DEP.
Right, I know that.
The DEP, yeah, sent those comments, so.
Well, is it a request from George to amend it? So I wrote down amend the order of conditions, so I have a new one. I filled it out as an amended order of conditions. So, and they sent that 401, letter. We need to respond to it, and this is gonna be our response, because the gentleman on the other end of the phone wasn't picking it up. So we don't have any actual conversations with him.
Do we tear up the old order of conditions?
It just, yeah. I don't know if it's attached, but this is the prevailing order of conditions for this project for now.
Same number,
yeah.
Same DEP number.
It's good for 5 years, is that correct? Or three?
This, it's good for 3 years, and then we can extend it up till, I don't know, or whatever, you know, we can do whatever here, but, and that was Pam's concern, because the only reason why the other one lapsed is because someone in engineering wasn't paying attention. I don't know if it was supposed to be me paying attention, but it did lapse, or the, well, we would have had a better permit. That allowed more work than this one does. Specifically, her objections was to all the various amounts of disturbance in certain areas, so that's why
I
was a problem.
I don't like to belabor this trivial point, but we have that problem down by kind of by the DPW garage where the trees are actually growing in the culvert. Now
they've got to file for that.
They file that separately as an individual.
That's what we determined that they have to. We told them
they have to file an individual permit for that.
Because that is within the resource
area. It is definitely within the resource area.
Okay, so that we took out those. Any further questions or discussion? No? Okay, do we have anybody from engineering tonight?
No.
No, okay. Okay, there was a motion, it was seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? No. Okay.
I think it's time.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, we can go home now, right?
Almost. Okay. We have the next item on our agenda is the continued notice of intent 270-0643 Zero Main Street, Map 51, Lot 95, Ahern. That's now being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted as follows. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. As I mentioned earlier, there's an attendance sheet at the front door. Please sign in. This is a public process, and we'd like to have record that you were here. And at this time, just as a formality, let's introduce ourselves, starting with Julie.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
Rebecca Longley.
Jamie Maughan.
Anika Scanlon, Chair.
Brian Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Chuck Tarani, Conservation Administrator.
Okay, and representatives of the project.
Yep. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. I'm the design engineer for the project. I'm here with the applicant tonight, too, with Rob Ahern, who's in the back row. I wasn't at the last hearing. Steve Erickson of Norse Environmental presented the project. He had performed the wetland delineation for this project. Since that original plan, we took comments from the public and from the commission, and we've modified the plan. We also had a site walk with the Conservation Commission with Norse Environmental on site, Some of the wetland flags were moved. They were moved further up gradient onto the property. The revised wetland line is shown on the revised plan.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Just for the sake of the public, because I believe the number of people here are interested in this project,
yeah.
Just because I see some familiar faces. Could you just describe what got changed in the wetland line as a result? Could you just point it out?
Sure.
And feel free to stand on.
Yeah. This side?
Whatever you think would be best visibility.
I'm blocking anyone.
Yeah, thank you.
The original, there were flags 1A, 2A, 3A, 4A, 5A. Everyone was in agreement that those flags were correct. Then we went from 5A to 6A to 7A to 8A. Upon the site walk, there was a feeling that 6A was too far into a wetland area, should be moved up gradient, and 7A was too down gradient as well, it should be moved uphill. So
well, were they physically moved in the field as
no,
well?
No. So instead of actually relocating those two flags, when we actually looked, and Norse Environmental was out with an auger, they were looking at soil conditions. They did a number of soil augers that everyone observed. And when they looked at basically where the new line should fall, they said if you connect flag 5A to 8A and eliminate flags 6 and 7A, that is where the line would fall. So note the 6A and 7A are eliminated. I left them on the plan just to show where they used to be. But I put a note on the plan saying revised wetland line and dated it.
Did you remove flags 6A and 7A?
I did not remove them.
Yeah, I suggest that we relocate those flags on the new wetlands line so during construction we can physically see in the field where they're located.
The distance off, that's fine. I can put those on the line. So that was one change. So once that change was made, it really affected the project. The old house that we showed now wouldn't fit. It was about 30 feet away from the new wetland line, and under your bylaw, we need to maintain 35 feet from a wetland line to a structure. And some of the other concerns that people had, previously there was a retaining wall that ran the majority of the limit of work line.
A proposed retaining wall.
And it was going to be a landscape retaining wall, which means it wouldn't exceed 4 feet in height. But due to some of the site grading that we needed for the previous home that we showed, there would have been a need for a large amount of retaining wall. There was also concerns with the amount of trees that would have to be cut as part of this project. So per the direction of the commission, I'm not sure if neighbors requested this as well, I went out and survey located all trees 6 inches in diameter or greater within the proposed work area, not over the entire 4 acre site, the majority of it's wet, but within areas that could be cut, I located them to show what would be removed and what would stay. So I basically went back to the drawing board. I had a talk with Mr. Ahern and I said, we need to pick a smaller house. Previously there was a garage that was gonna be on the left side of the house. I suggested flipping it to the right side. By doing that, we'd eliminate a lot of pavement that previously was shown on the previous plan, and it gave more of a direct access from the proposed curb cut to the garage. I also looked at eliminating the majority of the retaining walls for this project. So now, at the back of the house is a small retaining wall, about 15 feet long, 4 feet high. There's a retaining wall.
Where is that deck? I don't.
I'm sorry. See where the deck is? There's a proposed.
Oh, just to the center of the deck?
Yep, there's a small
okay.
wall.
I see it.
Yeah. There's a small wall that extends here, to the corner of the house. And then off the driveway, there's another small wall here. So on the previous plan, there was a wall that ran all the way around that has been eliminated. I also, previously, the house was larger and it was approximately 46 feet off the front property line. So I reduced the size of the house and I moved the house closer to the front property line, and now it's 28 feet away from the front property line. The reason I did that is because there were a number of large trees that we wanted to retain in the rear yard. Some 20-inch, 18-inch, 24-inch pines, 18-inch pines. If the house was to be further back, those would have been eliminated. So I made an effort to save as many trees as I could. I've given a summary on the site plan showing the total number of trees greater than 6 inches to be removed on this project. There's a total tree removal. There'll be 12 conifers, which are pine trees, 9 deciduous trees to be removed. So to mitigate, over 4 acres, that's not too bad. We're only removing 21 trees on the site, 6 inches or greater. But with that said, I know it was a concern. I did speak to the direct abutter when I was out locating the abutter right here. And there was some concerns, with the site grading of trees would be removed. So we're proposing some arborvitaes, which will stay green throughout the year, be planted along the lot line. And I believed I showed 3-inch caliper red maples to be planted.
Do you think those red maples, you have them in the upland area?
I do have them in the upland area.
If a nursery or an arborist is okay with that, fine, but red maples, you think of okay.
And the reason I wanted to get some plantings in the upland areas because that's where I'm removing them from. So
yeah.
It's not a one-for-one mitigation. That's basically impossible when you place a driveway, a house. But I tried to provide some landscaping to put back some of the trees. But I'm hoping, I have had a number of discussions with neighbors. I'm not sure if I received calls immediately when notices went out, at least from 4 or 5. So by trying to pull this forward, the majority of the trees, including some 30-inch plus trees, will remain that previously might have been removed as part of this project by moving the house forward. Additionally, the commission was looking for drainage. I've done some rain garden designs on some other projects. Rain gardens are nice, but they take up some area. So on this site, it's a nice landscaping feature too, and it provides drainage. But on this site, if I was to try to get a rain garden in to the yard, it would involve more tree clearing. So what I decided to do is I'm showing 2 proposed dry wells. So the entire roofed area of the proposed house, the front portion of the roof will be piped to a 500-gallon dry well in the front, and then the rear roof area will be piped to a 500-gallon dry well in the rear. And that way, any stormwater coming off the roof will not go out to the wetland area. It will basically go into the soil, and it'll be recharged. I know there's concerns with ledge on this project. The areas that the dry wells will be going in are areas of fill, so they'll be set in clean sand. So we will be able to get, even if there is ledge below, water will be able to move through that sand. And
did you do a test pit?
I did not.
How do you know that it's fill in those areas?
Because I'm proposing about 4 feet of fill.
Oh, I see. Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
So it's new fill.
New fill.
Okay.
Yeah. Again, all the smaller retaining walls that I'm showing, again, none of them exceed 4 feet in height. If you get over 4 feet in height, they become a structural wall. You're required to have a structural engineer design the wall, and it would have to be submitted to the building inspector. So all walls are 4 feet or less.
While we're talking about drainage, what about the drainage from the driveway? Where does it go?
The drainage from the driveway will go out towards Main Street. Where this is a state highway, I may have to put some sort of trench grade to collect water before it goes out to Main Street.
So the new elevation of the house, the garage, can be above Main Street?
Correct.
Be higher than Main Street?
Correct. So the garage floor I have at 107, and the existing ground grade at the property line where we meet Main Street is at 106.75, so there's 3 inches of pitch from the garage back towards Main Street. Now, I do have to file with MassDOT for the curb cut work and the utility work for this project. I have not done that as of this date. But sometimes with residential driveways, they may not give me a hard time on drainage going out. I know on a commercial driveway, I definitely would have to contain any drainage going out to the state highway. I still may need to for this driveway.
Why is it draining out to the road? Is that just I chose a selected designer, is that code, or is that?
I actually selected it that way, and it actually works out well, because that garage grade of 107, the left side of the house is gonna be a full walkout basement. So the way I was able to eliminate the retaining walls is I made the full left, basically the full left side from the chimney back, and a large portion of the rear house to be a walkout. Previously, the larger home had a walkout basement in the rear, but by selecting a new house design, that's how I was able to basically get this house to work a lot better with the site grading. Yeah, I won't need the large mass of retaining walls, and I still get positive drainage from the garage out to the street.
So you're saying the foundations can basically be the retaining wall?
Well, now...
To some degree.
My basement floor will basically match into the existing grade.
To the existing grade.
On ground.
That small rectangle just above 101 in parentheses on the left side of the house? Is that the chimney?
That's the chimney.
Oh, okay. Right.
So there's right behind the chimney, to the rear of the chimney, is where the walkout basement starts. And if you look at that, I have a spot grade of 98.66.
Yeah.
And there's a 98 contour there, so the basement floor is 8 inches higher than the grade that's, you know, 6 or 8 feet away. So I tried to match in as close as I could to the existing grades, and not have to do extensive grading or any type of wall.
So when you say proposed 2.5 story, is that half story the basement?
No.
So it's 2.5 plus the basement?
Correct.
Do you know how many square feet the living space is? Have you done that calculation?
I have. The first and second floor are 1,600 square feet.
Yeah.
And then if it'll be an unfinished, like loft area, that's about 500 square feet. So you're looking at a house, if everything was finished out, it would be 2,000 to 2,200 square feet. They're not planning on finishing the attic at the loft area at this point, so the finished area would be 1,600 square feet. Unless a buyer wants it finished and wants it, they'll do it.
So is part of the reason to add the fill in the backyard because the water table elevation is too close to the ground surface?
Correct.
Do you know roughly the elevations across the site?
I do, because if you look at where the wetland flags are, basically they're running along the contour line of 96.
Yeah.
So I would assume the water table would be around elevation 96.
And the current elevation of the house is 100, right?
There's a 102 contour running through the proposed house and a 100 contour.
Right.
And the proposed drywall, what's the height of that?
I have the front one is at elevation 104, the top, and they're basically 2 feet 10 inches high. So it's well above. The one in the rear yard, you're looking at an elevation of like 99, so it may just be above the water table, but it's not 2 feet above, like if we were doing something that required DEP stormwater design, but.
Okay. Any other questions from commission members?
It's from the roof. So it's clean. So sometimes with roof runoff, you're allowed to get a reduction to a 1 foot separation from your water table to the bottom of your drywall.
Yeah, roof runoff's clean.
By
the stormwater rates.
So I think I addressed most of the concerns, but like I said, I wasn't attending the last meeting. I did get a summary of some of the comments from Chuck and from Steve Erickson from Morris Environmental.
Yeah.
But I think we made substantial improvements to the plan and using a smaller house, pulling it forward, lessening the amount of pavement, adding drainage, trying to save as many mature trees that we can, provide some additional tree plantings as a buffer to the neighbor and enhancement plantings to the project, and really tried to limit the amount of grading that needed to be done on this project.
Yeah. At this point, any questions from commission members? No? Chuck?
No.
No questions at this point?
It's not questions, it's a comment.
Go for it.
And maybe I should make this comment because it might give the engineer some ideas. But we've had smaller parcels than this come before this board proposing two houses. So I think that this, particularly with these improvements, is reasonable.
Thanks for your comment. Questions or comments from the public? Please just introduce yourself. Please stand and introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Karen Carr, and I live at 1257 Main Street. I have a question about, I have actually two questions about the fill. The first question I have is, as I know on the original plans, over close to the line, it is about to the wetland line, it's about 96 feet. But the house itself is at 107 now, as opposed to 108. You said it's only about 4 feet of fill. I don't think we go uphill that much between there and where the house is going to be. Just the observation of being there for 25 years. So my question is how do you calculate it's only 4 feet of fill if you're going to be going from probably, I would say, 98 feet, maybe even 100 feet, up to 107?
Okay. Well,
and the road's at 106, is my understanding.
Correct. So, just so you know, the wetland line's basically at elevation 96, as I talked about. We can't revisit the Reading by Concom bylaw says you can't do any work within 25 feet. That's your no touch zone. So when you move out 25 feet, we're moving up to an elevation roughly 98. So you pick up
35 feet
to a structure.
Okay, structure.
A structure. So 25 is a no touch.
Right.
You can't cut a tree. Everything has to stay as is. 35 is to a deck, to a house, to a shed, to a structure. So when you get out to the 25-foot setback line, you're roughly at elevation 98. So you picked up 2 feet right there.
Right.
My basement floor, as I said, was at 98.66, which is 98 feet 8 inches. So I'm 8 inches higher than the ground grade with my basement floor. If you look out the front door here, I have a proposed elevation of 106, and as I said, going through the center of the house where it basically averages 101. So there's about 5 feet of fill at the worst spot on the site.
Do we have the right one? Because this one shows at the garage 107.
107 at the garage.
So and that's 7 feet.
Okay, no, so, and there's a 102 contour now at the garage. So there's 5 feet, the garage will be 5 feet higher in that location. When I was saying 4 feet, basically, the worst case is 5 feet of fill. Most cases, we're averaging about four. And the real reason I'm pointing out 4 feet is the retaining walls. No retaining wall is over 4 feet in height. And if you get out to your property line, you're basically at a 104 elevation. So the foundation's at basically 107. So the foundation will be 3 feet higher than the ground grade at the common lot line, which is here.
Okay.
Which isn't that you have to leave at least 8 inches of exposure on a foundation to the ground surface anyways. So if the foundation's at top of foundations are 107, your ground surface, your minimum would be around 106, which would be 2 feet higher than your property line.
Okay. And then the second question I have is what is the elevation going to be towards the back? You said you're going to put fill in the back. What is the elevation going to be there in the back?
Yep. There's going to be a small retaining wall right here.
Right.
So from this point over to the wetland line is a walkout basement. There'll be no fill in that area. We're matching into the existing grade. So from this point over, this area here, we're matching the existing site grade. There's no fill.
Okay, so beyond that retaining wall towards the back of the old, where you showed the old retaining wall, there will be no fill there too?
And it's not as bad. Back here, there's probably 18 inches of fill back here. If you look, I have a proposed elevation of 102, and the existing grade's around 100.5, so there's about 18 inches. Yeah, that helps, Chuck, thank you. See the proposed elevation of 102? That's tying into this contour, which is 102. There's a 100-foot contour here. So right in this spot here, there's about 18 inches of fill.
So as you go further back, there's no fill?
No, there'll be no, right at the end of this wall.
Nope, keep moving.
That's okay.
There you get it nice.
From the end of this wall.
Sorry, Jack.
From this,
right.
That's okay, Chuck. From this, all this back here is not going to be touched. All those trees are going to remain. Now, Rob could go in, lumen seed around the trees, do what he wants to do, but all those trees will remain the same. We're not making any grading changes. If we made any grading changes in this backyard, it could affect the trees. You can't. You would have to put tree wells, or you'd end up burying the tree, maybe killing the tree. So basically, the way I graded this out is, whatever grade you see back here now is going to remain as is.
Okay.
Now, Rob would have rights to go in and lumen seed that area. You see I show an erosion control barrier back here. So there'll be no work beyond this point here. But I set this up so these trees would remain in place, but he'll lumen seed the yard.
So before this work, you're going to actually put a line where my property is, because it doesn't, it's, I mean, if you're standing at the roadway, it doesn't look necessarily like a straight line. It looks like it's skewed, probably because of how they did my property. Because I'm really concerned, because at the end of where I have, more or less cleared, it's pretty low. And I'm just hoping that you're not bringing things up high enough that then the water drains off and I can then have a new pool sitting in one corner of my backyard.
Right, and that was half the reason probably the commission asked for some sort of drainage on this project. So, like I said, the entire roof area is being placed to dry wells, and the driveway is going out to Main Street. So there's really going to be no water basically being shed onto you. But your point is a good point. When I met you out when I was locating the trees, it's very difficult to tell where that lot line is. And when it comes to time for construction, I would mark this lot line, and I also have to physically mark out where the foundation's going, so that when they go to dig the hole, they know where they're digging, and then when the guys go to set their forms for the foundations, they know where to put the forms. So that's part of not only getting permitting, but then there's a lot of construction layout that I do, and there's as-built plans that I need to submit to the building inspector and to the Conservation Commission, verifying that if this gets approved, what is approved is what is actually built.
Well, if the neighbors wanted, would you be willing to put one of those orange construction fences down the property line to make sure that no activity escapes onto the neighbors?
Probably a good idea.
Would that be helpful, or would that be too ugly?
It would be helpful. It'd be helpful for me, but given just last week I had two beautiful deer walk across and into my yard, I'm a little concerned what it's going to do to the wildlife back there. But they're probably going to start staying away because they're going to be doing the construction. But
yeah,
I just don't want them to get tangled up in something too. I mean, I would love to see that. That's what my concern is also there's a lot of, we have fox, we have coyote, we have deer, we have all sorts of things that walk through there, at least right now.
It wouldn't go all the way back, so they'd still be able to get through, but maybe from this point back, we could put, what a lot of towns like to see is either like the black silt fence that sometimes we use for wetland control, or some sort of construction fence. And the idea is too, like during construction, sometimes debris can blow. Like the wrapping they use for plywood, they put it into a dumpster, they haul it off, but on a windy day, you don't want materials blowing onto your property. So sometimes a construction fence would prevent anything from going onto your property. So I think it's a good idea if you're open to it. We're not opposed to it.
Well, I would like to know exactly, because it is sort of difficult where the line is, especially given that it has a downhill slope right there. And where I think it goes, there's a lot of trees right there, and I know you have some of them marked here, but it's still hard for me to see exactly to picture it right now. And I didn't see the markings for the ones that you said you were taking down from when I was looking at it, because I mostly looked at it from the edge of my house looking forward, and I did not see anywhere in trees in that direction towards Main Street.
The trees that are coming down are the ones with the X's through them on the plan, so.
Yeah, but you have some with the X's up near the Main Street, and I didn't see those marked.
Oh, I didn't mark them to come down yet.
Oh, okay.
They will, you know, assuming we get approved, we get an order of conditions, then they'd be marked. Right now, this is just a proposed plan. If everyone agrees and this gets approved, then they would come down and they would be marked. And the commission usually in their order says, you know, prior to the trees being removed, they need to see, Chuck does a sidewalk, checks the erosion control, make sure the trees that are supposed to come down are marked to come down. And so there's a check and balance system in the whole process.
Okay, any more questions from the public?
Yes.
Yeah.
532 Tom Walsh, 532 Pearl Street.
Yeah.
Jim, you made the point, but I think it's tough to sort of distinguish or have a starting point. You've asked them to move that boundary out to really represent where it should be. So without that starting point, I think, I mean, the foundation is 40 feet off that, but was it agreed upon by everyone that that was the starting point? Did you, without physically moving that, you agreed to a spot, or that just seems weird to me that.
Can you just specify, are you talking about the wetland
six,
line?
Seven, eight,
the wetland line?
The wetland line.
Okay, just to let you guys know what happened. There was a site visit discussed at the last meeting, and we coordinated on a time that a good number of whoever was available, you know,
so
whoever was interested from commission was that, you know, we coordinated our schedules and we went out on site.
Everyone went out.
No, what? No. Myself.
I went out.
Okay.
And Chuck Taroni.
And I'd been out previously.
Yeah.
So
and we met Mr. Sullivan, and we met their wetlands specialist who was here presenting at the last meeting. And we met another field technician who was, so there were three representatives from the applicant, and we basically walked around the woods saying, well, let's take a look at the soils here, and then looking at the slope of the land, the type of plants that are growing there that we could see, and, you know, seeing something on a plan.
And the soils also.
And the soils.
Check the soils, because you can visually see wetland soils. They look different than upland soils. So I took a little hand auger and went down in the soils and looked at those.
So we saw, I mean, I saw at least three soil samples. I know that there were, I can't.
So the board was in full agreement on whatever spot that was, that
we
wasn't marked.
It was our opinion that those flags, 6A and 7A, which you see, you know, to the left there, 6A and 7A, you know, it's not, unfortunately with these wetland lines, it's not as clear cut and dry as like a carpentry cut. You know, it's a natural system, and it's got a little bit of, you know, it's a very gray area to try and put a line through. It was our opinion that 6 and 7 were a little too far towards the wetlands. We thought that the line needed to come up a little bit, especially in that area.
So
if you remember from the last meeting that we had, Mr. Mohn said, you know, when I went out there and inspected, he was the first one out, he says, oh, there seems to be some vegetation, specifically cinnamon fern,
right. Yep.
That was seemed to be a little bit above the wetland line. So
yeah,
that's when we came out. Mr. Mohn didn't join us, but Anika and Chuck and myself were there, and we said, okay, let's do some soil samples, you know, below in the wetland and above, and see what we come up with. And I think that the general feeling was that the slope kind of dictated, really, you know, from, I guess, the, is it flag 7?
Flag 8?
Flag 8.
Flag 5.
Yeah. And the soils were a little iffy.
Right.
But I think, in my estimation, kind of erred on a little conservatively and went up a little bit towards the wetland. So, you know, I think.
I mean, it wasn't, you know, us going out and saying, yes, yeah, let's just put it right here. I mean, there were soil samples taken, there was a deliberative analysis and review and an open discussion of what the evidence was saying.
But we are now in agreement that that is the best line that we can.
That we can agree to.
I think we can feel comfortable.
I understand what you're saying, going from 5 to 8, but it's not marked, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so let me just back up just for a second. I think I understand the question. So you're saying, why didn't the flags get moved while we're out on the field?
And then you measure from there.
Well, while we're out on the field, it was decided that we could move the flags, but that contour line that we wanted to stay on represented a straight line from flag 8 to flag 5. And when we were out on the field, all the parties agreed to move the line. So we moved the line, the flags still remained. So we really didn't hang new flags, but it was agreeable. So everyone decided that that was what we wanted to do. So we knew when we left the site where the line was going.
All right, my second question then would be, on the trees, you indicate you're cutting down 12, 6 inches or greater.
21. Total.
That's 6 inches or greater, though. How many trees are you cutting down total in this area?
The scrub stuff, I'm not counting. But anything 6 inches or over, I noted, and that's what we're taking.
So that's
down.
All you measure, 6 inches or greater?
Yeah, you don't go out and locate every little 1-inch sapling.
Just, you know, seeing the property, it looks to me like there's been a lot of trees, many more than 21 to be marked. Whether that indicates they're coming down or they're just marked for some.
Those were marked so I didn't get lost when I was trying to figure out what tree I located. So I put a little spray dot on the trees I located, because it sounds easy when you're out there like, oh, I got this tree, I got this tree, but then all of a sudden you're like, did I get this tree? So I put a little orange dot on each tree that I located. That's no indication if the trees to remain or to be removed. It was just something so I could keep track of what I was doing out there.
Okay, so, and then my last question, I guess, would be, where you're proposing, where the deck is on the back of the house, and you're saying you're not gonna landscape, that area's gonna drop. What's the drop from sort of the fill line? There's a retaining wall there, but what would be the drop off there as far as where you fill to, where your deck is, where your retaining wall is, the 4-foot retaining wall, the drop off into that sort of area where you said the owner could landscape and do stuff around the trees in back there. Is there a drop there?
No.
There isn't?
No. No. The grade that you see there now is what will be there. He'll be able to loom and seed it, but the trees would remain. The deck is going to be elevated. It's coming off the first floor, and there'll be Bigfoot supports, but whatever that existing ground grade, there might be a change of 6 inches in the ground grade, but we're not making major changes. And around these treed areas, there'll be minimal changes. He may scrape the leaves aside, put in some loam, and seed it, but the trees will remain.
Now, because the property's in a wet, in a flood zone, is there any?
It's not in a flood zone. It's in a 500-year flood zone. If you're in a 100-year flood zone, that's what's regulated under the Wetland Protection Act. You don't have to offer compensation in a 500-year flood.
Okay. The map I looked at online indicated it was in some type of flood zone.
It's in a 500-year flood, but that's not something that's regulated by the commission. It's noted. If it was in a 100-year floodplain and I was doing any filling within that known 100-year floodplain, I'd have to offer flood compensation. But you can tell from this site, how we talked about contours, we have an elevation of 104 down to 98, there's a 6-foot drop. So maybe in a flood it gets up to 98, it's never going to get up to 104 in that area. It would flood out the neighbor. So we're not in FEMA did a big study, we're not in a designated 100-year floodplain. That's about as simple as it gets.
Any more questions from the public? Did you have any more? Mr. Wall?
Not this time.
Okay. Yes, just please introduce yourself.
Scott Berger, 1301 Main Street.
Okay, thanks.
So what is, forgive me for maybe not understanding the process,
But we're talking about one corner of this lot, and it's a 4-acre lot. What is the intent for the entire 4 acres? Is this being subdivided? Should this proceed? Future owner of this house, are they buying a quarter or a half acre, or are they buying all 4 acres?
They're buying the full 4 acres.
And so, with the submission of this plan for this building on this 4 acres, is this the entirety of what they'd be allowed to do, or would they then be allowed to build other structures or decide they want 3 acres of yard?
I can answer that.
Well, this approval, if we approve it, would be for what's shown on this plan. If somebody at a later date wanted to propose something else, they'd have to go back through the process. We're not approving anything else other than what you see on here. And if you look at the lot, once they do build that building, by putting it where it is, that leaves very little upland land left to develop on, at least on the south side of that wetland. So I can't say for sure that nothing would be allowed, but it would be problematic to try and build another property on the south side of that lot.
Just and one more follow-up on the point of trees that would be coming down. The comment that 21 is not a lot on 4 acres. What I would like to speak on behalf of the 4 acres, that most of the trees are in that spot of that house. Like the middle of that 4 acres is marshy wetland that I don't believe anyone's really trying to put there. But there aren't trees there either. I mean, most of the trees in this lot are actually up against my property line. I couldn't speak towards the borough, I don't see it as much. But
I'm sorry, where's your property?
I'm 1301 Main Street, so I'm the corner of Main and Nelson.
So you're north.
So I'm the northern border.
You're immediately north of this lot?
Yes.
We're at the other dry tip there on the corner. Oh,
yeah.
Going.
Yeah. North. Any other questions from the public? Go ahead.
It seems that the sewer connection has changed also.
No.
What, are you proposing a little lift station at the house to get up to the existing sewer?
Correct.
And where will it exit the property? Is it shown on here and I don't see it?
Yes. See this?
Oh, I see it. PSA, I see it now.
So
okay.
The sewer to a grinder pump, it's going to go here and then it's going to go up to this manhole. See, most of that's outside the 100-foot buffer zone anyways to the wetlands, but that I wanted to show that route. That would have to get approved by not only DPW but MassDOT as well.
Now, will that pump have emergency generator or battery?
It has in a case of a power outage, it either has it usually they come with dual pumps, so if one doesn't work, the other will kick on. In the event of a power outage, there's enough reserve capacity for one day's flow. Okay.
Very common.
So in a 3-bedroom house, it'd be over 330 gallons of reserve capacity. And if you think of it with a power outage, you're not really using that much water at that point in time, but there are emergency scenarios built into those pump stations.
Good portion of Gloucester is sewer.
Yeah, no. And Plum Island used to be.
Not Plum Island. Not the back in the deck. It's completely different.
Any other questions from the public?
The question. Sorry, Kevin Dyer, 524 Pearl Street.
Thank you.
Talking about the tank for the grinder pump. That is a completely sealed tank?
Yes.
No infiltration available?
Okay.
Sir?
Yep. Brian Tam, 550 Pearl Street. I'm mainly curious, is there a water flow study that's done, say, you know, if you're adding fill and you're kind of elevating this slope surface, do you analyze the water flow coming off of that surface? You know, if you're elevating a little bit more, are you coming down with water more towards the south side at all? Or?
Not for a single family home. Single family homes are exempt under the wetland bylaw for stormwater.
Okay.
Although to some degree you have done that with the infiltration.
I did offer the dry wells, so.
Which is not required.
Which is not required, but sometimes on new construction, and especially where, you know, we're 40 feet from a wetland, so it's something the commission asked for we have no problem offering it. If this was a subdivision of a number of homes, like four or more homes, then I do a detailed 100-plus page drainage study showing how peak rates of runoff are reduced in the post-development scenario versus pre, but for a single-family home, you don't get into that type of study.
Go
ahead.
I see just a slope going from south to north. I guess it's higher in the south and lower in the north, but now it planes kind of at the southern property line, or it kind of levels out the southern property line. I see that kind of as a nook where where water can build up and then start eroding. I guess where those trees, that tree line could start eroding.
You're saying right here?
Yeah, right there. Kind of flat. The site flattens out right there and then going south.
Well, you see, there's a 108 contour here.
Yeah.
106. So from this 108 to 106, we're moving. The water's moving this way.
Okay.
It's still going to move through the site.
Okay.
I didn't create a ponding
okay.
or puddling situation.
Right.
Water's still going to flow in the same direction.
Sure. I wasn't sure if it was going to slow down and then cause additional eroding. That would kind of pocket in that
east-west line. The exception is that a raindrop that now falls on the proposed driveway flows to the north.
No, it flows towards the road.
Well, right now it doesn't, but under
the
proposal it will. So
there
will actually be a fraction less water going to the wetland than currently goes to the wetland, but it's a de minimis amount.
But it would affect the drainage of the street, right?
It
increase the drainage of the street.
Yes. And.
But the street drainage discharges to low-lying areas anyway. So
it's running down the street and going through the storm drain
into the wetland.
Yeah.
It's just getting there faster.
All rolls downhill.
Yeah. Any other questions from the public? Yes.
Yes, Scott Berger.
Yes.
Sorry to just kind of piggyback, but
go ahead.
So this, if this gets greenlit and the property is sold, it's being sold from current private owner to the developer, correct?
Correct.
So then, once the house is done, the developer's going to sit on 3.5 acres. Is this going to be subdivided?
No.
What's
no.
the intent here?
If he was not that he couldn't subdivide it, it's within his right to.
Okay.
But if he was going to subdivide it, it would go to the planning board. There's upland requirements when you subdivide. You have to have so much upland in certain zoning districts throughout the town. You could subdivide this and just call 3.5 acres non-buildable. And keep a piece of wetland if you wanted to, and then you pay taxes on it. Most people don't want that. So are they within their rights to subdivide? Sure, they could. But the intention is to build this single family home and to sell it, as 4 acres.
And by improving and building this single family house where it is, it limits their, I don't want to say eliminate, but severely limits their options to subdivide. Some people would say it eliminates the options to subdivide, but it certainly minimizes the options.
One last question, then we can move on.
1257 in Karen Park, 1257 Main Street. The sewer line that you have going there, just to help me visualize this, because from my property line into this property, it's a downhill slope. Is it going to be at the bottom of that slope? Is it going to be in the middle of that slope? Where is it in conjunction to that line? Especially
well, when I mark out the property line, it'll be about 5 feet into up.
So it will be towards the bottom of the slope there?
Yeah, I guess so. If you look out at the street, there's a 108 contour. Where this is, there's a 104, so if that's your bottom of slope, it will be in a lower elevation.
A lower elevation.
Now these force mains only have to go down 4 feet in depth.
There's trees right along that line right now, and some of those trees you currently are indicating that are not going to be taken down. So what happens if the roots are...
I'm showing all of them to be taken down.
You're taking down the line that's sitting on my property.
No, there's one right on the lot line that will remain.
Okay, so the one that's...
So So they'll have to take some care around the root system when they do
that. So they'll have to take some care around that root system.
Yeah, but that tree is to remain. This tree right here.
And then, I know there's two trees, and it looks like you're not taking them down, that's a little bit further, which is literally across from my bedroom. But it looks like you're leaving those, right?
I left those because those are nice hardwood trees. Now, the owner may have to do some pruning of the tree. You know, we can't have it overhanging into the house, but they're nice trees.
Most of it overhangs onto my property, just so you know.
Oh, okay.
Because that's shading my bedroom.
Okay.
So,
but I was just
making sure that those were okay.
That was the idea. Those two are to remain. The nice hardwood tree, the 20-inch, 12-inch. You can see my grading. I didn't do any grading around them.
You didn't do anything with those, but okay. So the other one, though, you will take care of the root structure for that tree.
You'll have to.
Okay.
Okay.
That's what I was concerned.
Any more questions from commission members? No?
I wanted to ask one question.
Yeah, go ahead, Jack.
Jack, on the driveway, so you have that driveway going, all the sheet flows going out onto Main Street, and you're showing, but the topo lines that exist or are on the property now are going from south to north. Why did you not just do an infiltration strip at the around the retaining wall? Because that would clean up the water. If it goes down the street, it's likely to pick up pollutants, especially in the wintertime, and it just goes right into the same wetland. So what was the thought behind that, not to infiltrate the water coming off the driveway and just have it go right out into the street, plus the fact that you might not even get that permit?
I may not get that permit, you're right. I only have 3 inches of pitch from the garage to the street, so it's not a steep slope. Maybe it is a good idea to keep the water on site. I have a feeling MassDOT would probably like to see that. I don't have a problem adding like a trench drain or something at the driveway entrance and then going out to what Chuck suggested, like some sort of crushed stone filter strip right at that retaining wall. It's probably a good idea. My idea is I wanted positive drainage away from the house. I didn't want water coming back towards the garage, because a lot of times I see people do that. They put a dry well in front of the garage. People don't maintain them. The leaves come in, and then in a big storm, water rushes into the garage, and then Rob's getting a call, you know, and they're all upset at him. So my idea was just to keep positive flow.
So putting a gravel strip where? Between the lot line and the
turnaround spot?
Yeah, right at this retaining wall. If there was a way to move this water over into like a crushed stone strip, filter strip, I don't have a problem with that at all.
Okay. Okay. At this point, is there a motion to move this project forward?
I move we issue an order of conditions based on the plans dated. Looks like they're revised June 1st, 2015, with the change to the driveway drainage stuff.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay. So we're leaving the hearing. So I am now moved we continue the hearing. You think
June
24th? Work conditions done?
2 weeks, yeah.
Until we get the plan change for the gravel strip?
But you can wait. Is Jack going to have to provide any new information, maybe a revised plan?
And we also need those flags.
Oh, the bench.
Just relocated out in the field that everybody, you know, when you go to construction.
Okay, so I move
that's
here.
That's not going to affect the writing of the order.
Okay.
No, but it should. They probably should be positioned on the plan.
In real
life.
Yeah.
So I move we continue the hearing until June 24th, is that right?
Yep, June 24th. Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Okay.
this point, we're going to move on to our next order of business on the agenda, which is a request for determination of applicability for One General Way. Map 45, Lot 1, DNS Realty, Reading Realty Trust.
I got a board. I'm old school.
Okay. All right.
Tell you what, I'll put it up there so we can like you're looking
good.
At a video.
Right, those are hard to find now.
Good evening. Just for the sake of the record, we got to keep that.
For the record, I'm John Dick, Hancock Associates.
Good evening. Just pardon me. Yeah. Talk has to be.
We're on the board.
Yeah, we do. We have to open the
And I'm representing Dennis Redding Realty Trust tonight. This is a kind of an odd request for determination of applicability. I have thrown out a fair amount of information about what we intend to do, and I'm very briefly going to touch on what kind of project this is. It is an ecological restoration plan, and that's something new under the sun. Back in October, the DEP issued new regulations that Arapahoe Dictu, after 40 years, they finally acknowledged that you can't just walk away and leave wetlands alone. They need management, just like every other resource. So, DEP came up with the notion that, well, we can do ecological restoration. The problem here, we've prepared a notice of intent, we've got a plan which you're looking at. It's a very rudimentary plan at this stage because one of the first things we did writing the notice of intent was calculate the local fee. And your local,
I'm sorry, but calculate
local
your local fee, bylaw fee. Mm-hmm. And your bylaw fee was designed back in the days when you didn't touch wetlands, that was the law, that was the rule. I'll tell you what, let's make it really nasty to touch wetlands. Let's charge X number of dollars per square foot. Let's charge X number of dollars per linear foot. You total up the filing fee for this site, and it amounts to, I wrote it down, I can't remember it because I choke up.
You put in your letter,
$453,640, exclusive of the filing fee itself, which is $1,000.
Chuck, we can get you an assistant.
We could do an awful lot of conservation good.
We could get him a new town hall. and it would be nice if this was something of the nature of a major impact on airport, a golf course. But what we in effect are
now,
doing
just to make
is
sure that everybody understands that fee would be if you filed a notice of intent.
If we filed a notice of intent, which we have to do ecological restoration.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what I'm saying here is simply that this isn't $500,000 worth of work. I anticipate a budget on this thing about a tenth of the filing fee for actually doing the job on the ground. What we are trying to do is to restore some of the floodplain function on one side of the access drive to this complex. It's the market basket down off of Walkersburg Road. And on the other side, we need to remove some poplars and some other invasive trees that are endangering the stability of the bank and the detention basin. So a lot of this is very important work, but that's not what I'm here to discuss. I'm here to discuss the filing fee and how we get to, let's make a notice of intent out of this.
Can I just jump the gun for a second and ask you a question?
Yep.
At this point, you know, the regulations, and you've admitted this already, that the regulations require that a ecological restoration project be handled under a notice of intent, and yet you've filed a request for determination of applicability.
Strictly to talk about the filing fee.
So, I mean, procedurally, you know, in theory, we could vote now to issue a negative determination simply on that grounds.
I would suggest that what you want to do is issue a positive determination and tell us we don't have to pay you $450,000.
I think you'd hear from DEP if you did that.
Yeah. I'd like a negative determination, but yeah.
Scratch the negative.
Yeah,
positive.
Not happening.
Scratch that.
Yeah, we're not asking
to
reduce the fee.
I guess I'm just going to ask, why should we not just vote a positive determination?
You're perfectly welcome to vote a positive determination, but the question before the board is, what's the fee when we file the notice of intent?
We can determine the fee at, as part of the process. We've done that in the past. We did it at Austin Prep, for example.
But I think his argument is valid in that if we stick them with the fee, they're not going to do the project. It's as simple as that.
It just isn't going to happen.
Well, to make that decision, can you explain the project a little bit?
Yeah, it's really very simple. There are two components to it. There are two clouded areas, if you will. And those of you who are familiar with this, those of you who shop in the area, that sort of thing, know that there's a driveway coming in off of Walker's Brook Road. And then on one side of that driveway, there is a small detention basin. I think it was designed back in the 90s by Hayes Engineering. And that small detention basin is an after-the-fact kind of thing. There was a parking lot there. There was a ditched brook coming across the site, and the parking lot drained to the brook. In the course of various iterations of site plan review for this property, it's been through half a dozen filings, the detention basin and a replication area here got designed alongside the parking lot, and they got kind of shoehorned in where they could fit. Neither one of them works pretty well. The detention basin is small, but what we're trying to avoid there is that there are some 8-inch poplars growing in the dike that holds the detention basin out of the brook. If you remove the dike, it's not a detention basin anymore.
Can you locate all those poplars?
They're all right here in this area of the brook. Basically, if I counted them today, by the time I filed a notice of intent, there'd be 12 or 13 more. They're completely getting out of hand. Essentially, they're behaving as an invasive species in this area.
Approximately how many are there?
There must be 100 of them. It's the nature of poplars to vegetate like that. They grow up, and then at some point or another, they windthrow. The root disc comes up, the dike comes out of the detention basin, no more detention function. So that's an easy one. That's pretty much a no-brainer as far as ecological restoration goes. It's restoration of a designed condition that we kind of were, it was imposed upon the site by the fact that there was already a paved area and a mill here that was converted. So it's a reconstruction. It's not the biggest detention basin in the world. It's not the most effective detention basin in the world, but it does something that it can't do if the dike disappears.
And your note says here you would make plantings of herbaceous.
Oh yeah, so we're not gonna pave it. We're not gonna, you know.
And you're not going to change the grade or the structure?
Yeah, essentially, all we want to do is remove these big levers that might damage the integrity of the bank. Now, the other side.
Okay, is that area of that dike included when you made this calculation of $500,000 for your fee?
Yes, that's the bank.
Okay, because that project that you've just described for that bank, I think, is applicable to a request for determination and could be issued a negative determination.
That's an interesting idea. I would like to get the poplars out of there sooner than later.
So,
not to mention, it's part of the BMP, so it's probably not subject to them.
Right. So that could be a significant reduction in the fee right there.
It would reduce the fee by about 20%, by my estimation.
That's $80,000. If you don't want it, I'll take it.
Well, that's $80,000 less. That's still $370,000. The other side is a different situation. The other side used to be a floodplain. And over the years, again, the site was kind of imposed upon us, and to some extent the predecessors in title caused the problem. Folks come down and they dredge the ditch. Well, of course they do, otherwise all the urbanized sites above here flood. So the ditch has to be kept open, the flow has to be maintained. What do you do with the material you dredge out of the ditch? Well, you drive a Traco down the middle of the ditch and you side cast it. You don't side cast it on the parking lot, you side cast it on the north side of the ditch. And all along this side of the ditch, there's an irregular berm, 2, 3, 4 feet high, that effectively, when the brook comes up in the spring, prevents water from flowing out into what used to be a floodplain, which is now choked with red maples, invasive catalpas, and honeysuckles. We want to clear out a lot of that understory, most of the shrubs, we want to limb up some of the trees, and plant this, again, as a wet meadow, which is what it should be functioning as, and maybe breach the dike in two or three locations.
Limb the trees, does that mean you would perhaps cut some limbs, but not cut down any red maples?
Bingo. Yeah, there are some in coppice that have 8 or 10 stems on them. Maybe some of the stems should come out, but we don't really want to cut trees. We want to clear out the understory. And the reason for that being, we get more light, we can maintain some kind of understory in here, some kind of herbaceous vegetation, and make it function more as a floodplain than as an isolated vegetated wetland. Right now, it's not really hydraulically connected to the brook.
Are you changing, are you doing anything with that dike or that?
I'd like to get in there with Bobcat and make some breaches in the dike, yeah. It would improve the flow in and out of the brook in high flows.
So let me just back up. So the definition of a ecological restoration project is a project whose primary purpose is to restore or otherwise improve the natural capacity of a resource area while protecting, sustaining the interests of the Act, the Wetlands Protection Act, when such interests have been degraded or destroyed by anthropogenic influences. So your position is, first of all, what are the anthropogenic influences? Secondly, what are the interests of the Act that your work, proposed work, is going to restore or improve?
Easy. Anthropogenic influences are a dike along a channelized brook, a paved surface on the other side of that brook, a small detention basin that only functions if the dike maintains its integrity. Those are the primary considerations. And those are all hand to man, and those were all duly permitted kind of after the fact, because this facility was sitting here long before the Wetlands Protection Act was written. So what are we going to do? We're going to take the same wetland that's there now and make it function better as a floodplain wetland, which means better flood storage, better safety, better management of the brook's habitat function. It allows the water to come in and out of this basin without stagnating, without causing a lot of mosquito problems. When the brook comes up high, whatever's swimming in the brook can swim out into this wet meadow and at least make a hole in the larvae. But the real advantage here is that we get more storage on the site. There's less flooding downstream. There's restoration of a floodplain, which admittedly has residences here along Bolton Street and Village Street, and has a mill, and now that mill's been converted to a commercial parking lot and facility. All of that pretty much remains because it's grandfathered. We're just trying to kind of restore some of the function that's been lost by management of the site for anthropogenic.
One of my key questions is, where is the existing tree line right now, and where is it going to be moved to?
We're not
moving the visual tree line on the project. Is there going to be a substantial amount of, I mean, it looks like removing poplars near the detention basin between the driveway and Stop and Shop. Mm-hmm. What about, I mean, I see this dashed strip area, the 30-inch wide drainage easement. It, you know, the new clouded area.
Here.
Is that,
there's
this drainage easement
here
going to be?
The drainage easement is where the drainage easement is. It pretty much subtends the brook. And that's part of the problem, is that the brook was conceived not as a brook, but as a drainage easement, as an amenity carrying water from one set of paved surfaces to another and ultimately out of town. What we're trying to do here is, although there's a 30-foot wide easement running through the site, that 30-foot wide easement doesn't consider the possibility that there's a good sized piece of floodplain here. We built a wall between that floodplain and the brook. So now, all the drainage is in the 30-foot wide easement. What we'd like to do is to come in here, open up the understory. We're not changing grade, except to remove some of the berm along the brook. That simply lets water flow in and out of the floodplain.
What exactly does open up the understory look like?
Open up the understory looks like instead of 80% shrub cover, you might wind up with 40% shrub cover. We're not going to remove everything. We're taking out invasive species. Those species are listed over here on the left. Catalpa, there's about 8 good-sized catalpas out there, which are weed trees. Multiflora rose, we all know multiflora rose. Buckthorn and Asiatic bittersweet. And much of the limbing up of trees out here really consists of taking down drapes of bittersweet. Some of these trees are being strangled by bittersweet. Some of them are festooned with bittersweet. That's one of the invasives we really want to manage out here, just to get a little more light in. Why do we want more light?
What is the percentage of invasive species?
Right now? I'm pulling figures out of the air right now. The notice of intent is much more specific.
Right.
And to the degree that you want to get more specific yet, when we file a notice of intent, I'm happy to go out there and talk it over with you. And, you know, we'll take this one, we won't take that one. That's got to go. Hey, look, this catalpa's threatening the integrity of the bank. We could be very specific and take the can of spray paint and make marks on trees. But to get to that point where we negotiate, we got a $450,000 filing.
But 25%, 50%, I mean, I have an idea in my head. I'm just curious as to what the professional thinks.
Oh, about?
Invasive species.
About removal of invasive species?
No, 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 just what amount of the species right now, today, are invasive in that stand?
Somewhere around 60.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. It's bad.
Yeah. And red maple, bad. I don't know. I think red maple's an invasive species, but I'm not counting it because it's been mentioned in the Act.
Right.
Yeah.
It's a mess.
Madam Chairman.
There's also a sewer easement that goes through there.
Gas easement too. Yeah, there's all kinds of utilities out there.
Okay, is the berm you're talking about removing on that sewer easement?
No, the gas and sewer are parallel to General Ave, and the berm is out here along the side of the brook.
Well,
all we've been removing
is deposits.
There's
also a sewer easement, I believe, that goes from Bolton Street out toward General Ave.
It's not shown on the plan, but I'm going to hazard a wild guess that it would extend out along Bolt Street, the property line, but I'll look into it.
I think we had a map that the town provided us that showed that easement.
I'm writing it down. Where's the sewer easement? There's an electric easement. Oh, here it is. There's a sewer easement on this side of the lot, 20
no,
feet wide.
It's on the other side.
There's another one from Bolt?
Way, yes.
Ms. Longley?
Yeah, I have a bunch of questions.
Go ahead.
This site has a lot of history to it, and I'm a little confused about the detention basin to the south on General Avenue that has the poplars in that.
Yes.
Was that always floodplain in your estimation?
This?
Yeah.
No. No, it used to be, I believe it used to be parking lot.
Used to be what?
It used to be parking lot, I think. I believe there's an earlier plan by Hayes that shows
parking lot. So this was a detention basin put in to treat runoff from
the remainder of the parking lot.
You know, Frugal Fannies and Market Basket and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yes, after the fact.
And I guess the area now to the north of General Ave, you're saying that was a floodplain?
That's an abandoned floodplain. When the brook was in a natural state, that's where the brook went.
And when was the brook in a natural state?
Oh, Lord. Ancient of days. I'm 68. I expect that brook was ditched
long
before I was born.
So are you proposing to turn back the time and bring that to 1968 conditions?
What I want to do is I want to restore the function of this little segment of floodplain by taking out a little bit of accumulated material along the edge of the brook. And by accumulated material, I mean side cast dredged material.
Mm-hmm.
I can take you out there, I can show you the heaps of material. There are bones sticking out of them. Make some holes in it so the water can flow in and out of this floodplain, which is now not a floodplain anymore.
You also mentioned that area is 60% invasives in the shrub layer. how do you propose to remove the shrubs?
Weed wrench.
Weed wrench. Mm-hmm.
Wrench.
Wrench.
Or you're out of order, Mr. Mon.
And how invasive and disruptive is that?
Not terribly. You disturb the topsoil for a while, but I've got a seed mix specified. The whole idea here is to go in, get a landscaper to do this work. If spot applications of herbicides seem appropriate, for instance, in the case of bittersweet, that's a good alternative because then you don't have to yank the roots out. But I think in the case of bush honeysuckles, and there's some barberry out there, they're pretty easy to muckle onto and yank out of the ground. And once you've yanked them out of the ground, you rake the soil around again and you seed it. It's that simple. What we're trying to do is get more herbaceous cover, less shrub cover, open this up so that flow can come through in and out of this thing in its regular season. That's floodplain management, and it hasn't been done on this site since I was born.
And how many projects similar to this have you done?
I've designed 3 or 4 of them. I always had great difficulty permitting them because there was no such thing as an ecological restoration plan. Got a few done way back in the 80s when I started out because we had no rakes until 1983. And even for a while after that, some of the folks at DEP were very generous and considerate and would take into consideration, well, you know, maybe we could do some management with this altered wetland. But then we went into a 30-year period of preservation. And a lot of these problems have just been sitting there gathering steam over the years. That berm's not new. Nobody drove a backhoe down there 3 months ago and piled that thing up. It's been there for a long time. And it should come out. The function of the wetland as a floodplain is compromised by the presence of that dike and by the invasives that are growing in. Why are the invasives growing in? Because it's not wet enough. It's not getting enough water in season. You change the hydrology by letting the brook overflow in its season, you eliminate a lot of the invasive problem. Not all of it. They're going to come back, but they're not going to come back in force.
There are a couple of items that Mr. Tarone brought up during his meeting with you. A wildlife habitat evaluation, I mean, changing the nature of the understory changes the nature of habitat suitability.
Yes, and we do trigger that review.
We
do trigger 1060. It's one of those rare cases where we're altering so much wetland that there's an automatic wildlife analysis required.
There are a couple of other items that Mr. Tarone discussed that you mentioned in your letter. Emphasis on improvement and mitigation of wetlands previously altered by human activity.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll just sort of reiterate, you know, what Ms. Longley said, you know, that the current condition of a lot of these areas were thoroughly considered, planned, and designed during previous site development.
Mm-hmm.
To protect certain interests.
Yes, and
as
we're not intending to compromise. I'm curious.
I'm curious about the monitoring and maintenance practices that that should have been continued as part of that.
Hmm.
You know, have we received any reports? Do you know when the last time we received a report from Danis about the monitoring and maintenance of those? Okay, I'm interested to know how they've been doing that.
I'm not altogether certain that was conditioned, but
I'm sure it was in there.
Well, the constructed wetland may have a monitoring for
windblown debris or
debris and maybe some
invasives as well.
We monitored it a couple of years after it was done, and then that.
But as far as the wetlands it's highly unlikely.
Might be not
maintenance plan for the wetlands.
Yeah, I'd
I'm
say more of those are honored at the breach.
Monitoring
yeah.
maintenance conditions.
Of the created wetlands.
Of what was agreed to under that original order.
It's a created wetlands and there's a wetland replication area.
Yeah.
Yeah, the wetland replication area.
Yeah.
they did it, they put it in, we monitored it, it was successful, and there's been no more monitoring since probably 3 years after it was built.
Right, and it has the...
And is that in compliance?
203, 204, something like that.
Yeah, I think 204, Common Reads establishing itself there.
Right.
Okay. Let's see, restoration of floodplain function and habitat value, management of phragmites within the existing wetland mitigation area, and preparation of a detailed operation and management plan.
Those would all be part of the notice of intent.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we usually design those for 3 years because that's the term of a conventional order of conditions. An ACOP is five.
Design what for 3 years?
We usually design the monitoring protocols for 3 years because that's the term of an order. But if DEP decides to step in and review this thing independently, it'll go to five. And of course, you're within your jurisdiction to condition monitoring over a longer period of time.
But I can to move forward, as people are going to move forward.
Okay, can I ask four questions first?
I'll give you two. How about that? Can you put them into two?
No, I can't. One is there's been discussion of a trail as part of this enhancement. Is that something as you filed under the intent you'd be receptive, a notice of intent you'd be receptive to?
I have engaged in no such discussion.
The trail would be along that sewer easement. And I think
wherever the sewer easement happens to be, we're assuming it's out here.
Connect Bolton Street to General Way and ultimately to Walker Brook.
If I may, I'm Jody Hayward from Davis Redding Realty Trust.
Hi.
I'm not aware of any discussion other than the town is having an outside consultant look at best use down the road, you know, a 15, 20 year plan. And I don't know if that's what you're referring to, but there's been no formal discussion of a trail.
Okay, yeah,
right.
It wasn't in the letter.
Okay.
No, the trail committee has had that discussion.
Okay.
The PAN trail committee.
Yeah.
Is that something you could talk to them about and see if we can work into this?
Yeah, we're willing to work with everyone. And if I just may comment on one other thing, you mentioned any reporting from Danis Redden. We had worked with the town for the number of years through this, and you monitored, and we were successful, and we got a certificate of compliance to close everything out.
Right,
so,
right.
Just
right.
So everyone knows.
Right.
There's ongoing conditions, so. Which don't get closed out.
So we can check if there's anything that we need.
Yeah.
In addition to the monitoring, we'd be interested in management. If we go through all this and you spend this money to get out of these invasives, and then 4 years later they're all back, what have we really accomplished? So let's consider a long-term management plan as part of the notice of intent.
It's likely required.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then you already mentioned the phragmites. And my final question, why is Dennis doing this?
I'll give you the truth. There's a payday here. It's hard to see the stores from the main drag. This will open it up. That's their payday. And that's not a $450,000 payday. This project, if it was based simply on let's get the signs visible, it wouldn't be worth the filing fee. It wouldn't be worth the work. So it's an ecological restoration plan because that's where this kind of work fits. To some extent, I imposed the concept of floodplain restoration upon my client, who, came to me and said, can you open this up? Yeah, I can, and I think I should, and here's why. Because you're gonna lose the berm, you're gonna lose the bank, you've got invasives in this wetland and it's not functioning as a floodplain. Wow, there's an ecological restoration protocol in the books now. Let's give it a try. So that's the quid pro quo. That's why we're doing this.
Just gonna ask them. How, Jamie, I know you know, how high are the signs on the building?
14 feet.
So the most of the signs across the face of the building are 14 feet high.
They are the buildings for all practical intents and purposes.
It's not 30 feet up in the air and there's nothing on top. So there's been a lot of history on the site, and I haven't had time to look through it, but wonder if when the CPDC reviewed any aspect of the site, such as lighting, if they made certain conditions about shading, or if there was ever a plan given to the town showing how the lighting works. So I don't know if that was looked into, but it needs to be.
You mean the lighting on the driveway?
Lighting on the parking lot, and how it shades the residential area with the trees in place now. And I don't know what was said about that, maybe nothing.
I can tell you, and the rest of the commission, that it is likely that a filing under ecological restoration, you would not be able to ask that.
I'm not asking
it. That's true. But
I'm saying if the CPDC has put a condition on there that they need to maintain those trees, they're not going anywhere.
I just want to tell you that this ecological restoration is very specific and it doesn't allow a lot of leeway.
I should have said this is just something to check out, because that's also a non-starter.
Yeah, I think it's a regulatory consideration. It's not a conservation commission consideration.
That's right.
Any other questions from commission members at this point?
I just have one more. Do you think by opening up that area and turning it into, and having it flood more often, the rest of those trees in there will end up dying out?
Probably not.
By opening up in the air, so it's only flooding out every once in a while. It's pretty much a dry area for the most part, kind of like Tamarack Swamp. And if we open it up and it floods more often, usually what happens is all the trees die. So we're saying, hey, look, we're going to look at these trees that are invasives, but ultimately they're all going to die.
We did do a river study that included that stretch and modeled the hydrology. Mm-hmm. So we should be able to look to see how often it will flood.
It'll be a one-year event for sure. And it may be a longer or shorter duration. I don't think it's going to have a considerable effect on the red maples that are growing out there.
What we should check based on that model.
Yes.
It's easy enough to control.
How long will it be inundated?
And the last question is, Jamie mentioned that a portion of this project could be considered under an RDA. Would you increase the amount of disturbance that we see on the other side of General Way, so you still maintain that 1 acre of disturbance if you split the project?
I think it's possible that can become an RDA.
I think there's a spot in the Wetlands Protection Act that allows that.
They just allow you to do that.
Yeah, it doesn't even have a permit.
Come up against any sort of permit.
But we would permit it in town. But
right.
Who's going to
design
a stormwater detention center with trees in it?
So as I understand the project, there would be zero ground disturbance except for breaking passages through that dike.
Mm-hmm. Larger or smaller, depending on the hydrology we observe out there.
Right.
Digging up the invasives is going to disturb the ground.
Well, yes, it is.
If you're really going to use a weed wrench.
Weed wrench.
No. That really doesn't disturb the ground, if you're right.
There's sure to be ground disturbance. I'm not going to lie to you. There's got to be ground disturbance. You can't go out and manage invasive vegetation without it.
You're not changing the grade.
No.
Not going in there with equipment.
Well, I think ground disturbance, I mean, if we went out there and saw how many shrubs they're removing, it might.
Well, later
your
it
mind.
Gets in the season, the crummier it looks. So
yeah.
I'm going to wait until it's August to file this thing.
Personally, that wetland has always aggravated the heck out of me. There's so many invasives in there. Every time I drive in that driveway, I just shake my head. I'm like, this is ridiculous. All these invasives in here, it's bad. It's bad.
And it's been there long enough that.
It's been there a long time.
Our regulations aren't to blame for this. It's just the way things are.
Yeah, there's also an upland area in there.
Yes.
You're not touching that, though, correct?
No. There's a tiny little fragment up here that isn't technically wetland, but it's been a long time since there's been a delineation out here. This is somebody else's line. So I'm going to say that certainly 95% of this is wetlands. I'm calling all of it wetlands for the purpose of my area calculations.
John, on this plan, this looks like the
tree line? What's over in here? Is
oh, it's all trees.
Yeah, I was going to say, is that
yeah,
trees
this,
over
this
there?
Tree line is simply and only the area where we're going to manage
your work.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, I got it.
So if you come up with an alternative proposal for fee calculation?
$1,000. That's your local filing fee.
$1,000 per what?
Notice of intent.
Based on?
That's your local filing fee. All of the rest of it, the other 453 odd, that's all square foot disturbance or linear foot disturbance.
Based on the bylaw.
In wetland and on the bank. Yeah, it's all bylaw, and it's all predicated on the assumption you must never touch wetlands, and we'll make it cost if you do. But here's ecological restoration saying, go in there and touch the wetlands.
Well, again, tell me again what the $1,000 is based on.
The $1,000 is the local filing fee. It's twice the state filing fee. It's $500 at the state level, $1,000 at the town level.
For what?
That's just for the notice of intent.
Well, it varies by residential property.
Yeah, I think it's a 3A or a 2. I don't know what the category is, but that's the category we
They didn't change the category with the ecological restoration?
No, they didn't. It's $500.
It's $500. So he's talking about the town side of the state fee. He's not talking about the bylaw fee.
Well, the bylaw fee is $1,000. It's twice the state fee. So you get $1,000 under the bylaw.
Oh,
you get
okay.
A portion of the $500.
But that's only one of our categories.
But that's just the filing fee. Then there are all of these collateral fees related to areas of disturbance.
I do have to mention that in my history on the Conservation Commission, we have never gone from a fee of something even close to the order of magnitude of what you've calculated for this one to zero.
I understand.
To zero.
But you've never had ecological restoration on the board.
And that's what I want to summarize.
We did have
our rules are in conflict with the new ecological restoration file. Our rules are created before it existed to penalize people from filling in the wetlands. So I think we need to consider whether our regulations are out of step with what the state allows now.
Which also couldn't just be a fee reduction. It also could be a banking of or a bond. So you might say, look, for ecological reservation, we're gonna reduce the fees because it helps.
It could
but
be.
We need
yep.
to monitor it for longer so
right.
there's a bond
That's
or there's
true.
A bank
yeah,
to draw
true.
From.
We always put a bigger bond when we need a wetland creation.
I think
we have
and it need to hold it longer.
We have had significant reductions in fee for Kent Curtis Gill and for Austin Prep. I mean, huge reduction.
Right, we reduced Camp Curtis Gill by $10,000+. We didn't give them everything back. We gave them, I think, the portion that they were restoring based on some mistake back in the 40s.
What I would suggest to the commission is the $1,000 plus a square footage fee on the areas where we break the dike. To calculate the area of the dike you're breaking. And take those number of square feet, multiply it down the number.
And then everything else is ecological.
Everything else is cleaning up invasive plants, as I understand it. Now I need to see the notice of intent.
Right.
It better be a good notice of intent.
What about a fee based on replacement costs? Did you, Brian, give us some numbers once on Mass Highways replacement costs?
It's very spot. That information is very, it's not very accurate. They just so vary. The numbers are so varied. When you look at the spread of the numbers, it's not an accurate. It wasn't an accurate estimation.
It seems that to come up with a number tonight, based on, and it's possible we can do this, but there might be a lot more than we're realizing right now to think about when we try to craft this number. That's going to kind of be the, you know. The bottom line for all the ecological restoration projects that come to town.
No, I don't think we can do that. We have to.
It might be something to think about.
I think what I would suggest that we come up with a number tonight, and my suggestion would be the $1,000 plus the preliminary calculation number of square feet of dike disturbed times the dollar value, and that be what the size of the check that you write with the application. Then as we debate and discuss the notice of intent, we can discuss changing that number.
So you're saying reduce that number?
Or increase it?
No, I don't, because you've got, I mean, you were talking about a bond.
There's a lot of, what about, you know, obviously the wetland, is it gonna be delineated again? Or do we care about that? There's a fee for, you know, reviewing the wetland line. Is that also going to be waived? There's a lot more fees than John told you about. He's picking one out of a bunch of categories. Which ones also apply, or do you think none of them apply?
Well, I'm just having trouble remembering. I thought for a commercial, you paid a fee, which I'm told is $1,000. Plus X number of dollars per X number of square feet of resource area or
litter. Those are the only two I consider. Chuck's right, there is a hassle of other fees based on the presumption that we're gonna talk about where the wetland is. I didn't intend to talk about where the wetland is, but if you want to, then you're entitled to charge it for.
Is there a fee for the number of feet of wetland?
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, it's review. It's
review.
Yeah.
If they're talking about working only in the wetland, why do we need to know where the wetland is? They need to know where the wetland is.
I do think we should have the previous, if you have them, which I'm sure you do, the previous wetland flags on the map and note that they're previous.
You can do that. Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, because that's a historic
right.
document, but
right.
as far as, you know, what, I'm not trying to stay out of it. You know, it's,
right.
it's kind of different.
You know, I don't know if we can reasonably get to a fee number tonight. I mean,
well,
I don't think we have enough information for that.
Let him propose it based on some guidelines that we give it, and then we can either accept it or reject it.
I think that specifically the wetland alteration fee was not intended for this. Now, all the other fees are something different altogether that we were talking about, the dike breaching.
John, what's our wetland fee? Which one are you calling out? The commercial, industrial, and other non-residential projects? That says $700.
Mm-hmm. When I called and asked about this, I told you that state fee was $500, whatever category that is, that's a two. And you told me that it would be $200. I don't know whether that's based on your wetland bylaw or whether that's...
So we don't even.
I don't know where that number came from.
The right numbers. So I gave
I
you the $200.
It says 1,000.
All right. So I don't know what that number came from.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's going to be a commercial project, it's $700. Then there's boundary delineation, the resource area.
Well, how much per square foot of resource area?
$1.11 per linear foot of resource area.
Per linear foot.
Yeah.
For bank.
Boundary delineation for any resource area.
Ah, yeah, that's the delineation.
That's
it's
$1.11
per linear foot.
Right, with a maximum of 1,110 for a commercial project.
Maybe that's where I got the 1,000.
Okay, so now we're up to 1,800 plus or minus. Temporary or permanent, this is the one that's probably crushing them. Temporary or permanent alteration is $1.25 a square foot, 1 acre of disturbance.
Yep.
44,000. How do we get to 400,000?
That's 44,000. Floodplain is 60 cents per linear foot.
Per linear foot? How do you have
a wait a minute. Does it say linear foot? Floodplain.
Square
foot, sorry.
That's 25
per square
foot. So that's another 22,000.
And this is, Jay is working a freshwater wetland, $11 a square foot.
Ah, that's what it
is. Are you?
So you could waive Jay, come up with the rest. You could, there's a lot of things you could do. But the thing is,
apply that $11 to the dike breaches.
Yeah.
I don't know that, to the dike breaches, yeah.
I wouldn't apply, I don't know if I'd apply the other.
Doesn't it make sense to just kind of like work through a few times and try to figure out what we're trying to do here?
Yeah, I mean,
I'm happy to do that and present it with a notice of intent. What I don't want to do is obviously move forward with a notice of intent knowing that we're going to wind up paying a filing fee that equals or exceeds the cost of the project.
Right.
Well,
that's nuts.
This project must be pretty important to Dana's Properties because they've
it's
only been talking about it
but
for
we're only
45
talking about
years.
$50,000 worth of work.
So we need to evaluate 45 years worth of anxiety over highlighting the site. And that has a dollar figure.
Before it was a market basket, they probably wanted it hidden from the public. There were some nasty things in there 50 years ago.
Yeah, that was before.
I have no idea what the sign said.
We had to clean that from hazardous waste when we put in that stormwater system. I don't know if you remember.
It should be a reasonable fee, and in the past
that's not there for looks.
I think we really, it would be nice for the commission to break with the habit of waiving fees for everybody. However, that being said, this project is a different project. I think the commission's in a bad habit of waiving fees for everybody that comes in front of us in one form or another.
Also, just remember, you've only got kind of a preview, a small primer of what's going to happen here. We're giving a fee based on.
No, I don't think we can.
Maybe a hope we have of what this thing's going to do.
I don't think that we can really make a definitive decision. At least I can't make a
I asked you about what the MassDOT Highway, what they do to ensure that a replication project and they have the right amount of fee on it. That would be something that it would make sense to me.
That's for the bond, though.
Yeah.
For the bond.
That's not for the filing fee.
The bond for this, because it's been, since 1980 or 2002, so 11 years, and we're starting to get invasives in there, and no one wants to touch it again. So we need that bond to be extended out many, many years.
Or mandatory management plan, which if violated would result in a notice of violation.
Mm. It's all going to be worked in.
I know that the management plan is in there. I know that. But how many years is it for?
Could be in perpetuity.
Mm.
Could be just like those stone markers.
So I'm getting the sense that we're not going to come down on.
I didn't expect you to name a figure tonight.
Yeah.
I would be perfectly happy to propose a figure and come back in 2 weeks if that's okay with my client.
Yeah.
We'll throw one at you. Then we'll ask for positive determination.
I can say that I am amenable to some sort of reduction, certainly, because the project is very worthwhile in my opinion.
Okay.
I don't know about anybody else.
Well, you say some sort of, I hear substantial. That's good. I can work with that.
That's correct. Substantial. It's not going to be $400,000. No. At least that's not what I would be thinking. So.
My reservations about the project is, the design of what's there right now has been set up because of a significant amount of effort by Danis and by the town of Reading to set up drainage and wetlands in a situation that was, historically agreed to. And if that is going to change, I need to understand the analysis of how it's going to change, what the impacts are, and whether it still protects the interests of the act.
We have to improve the conditions.
Maybe I missed it, but I didn't hear anything that's going to change from what we've
if
heard.
If the character of the understory is changing, then the nature of the habitat is changing.
So I'm
talking about
picture. Wasn't part of the original plan. The original plan was only that created wetland and their detention basin, and I didn't hear any proposed changes to either of those two areas other than get the Phragmites out of the created wetlands.
Most of that is management of what's already there.
Right. I didn't hear any proposed changes to that created wetland or the detention basin that would affect their function.
Well, I don't know because I don't have a proposed plan.
Oh, right. I realize
so,
that. Well,
I
have
so to
Are you taking out on the berm that the stream?
Yes.
You're taking out some of the side cast material.
That's
correct?
Right.
And so now you're changing the hydrological regime a bit in there?
Yeah, exactly. We're going to allow the stream to flood its floodplain.
Yeah, we're changing
the
floodplain, no question, but we're not changing those two areas that we've
But no, the constructed wetland and the detention basin are maintenance considerations. We need to protect their function as they were designed.
What if they
were,
They
would be affected.
They might be working, you might be working on that side too, right?
It's all connected.
Yeah.
You're
lining
up.
Right.
Bear in mind there's no berm along the constructed wetland because they removed it when they constructed it. that berm's already been breached. There were berms on both sides of this brook, for sure.
And that's where the water comes from, that created wetlands, that the channel.
The side cast material, had that been there before Dana's developed that area?
I'm pretty sure Dana's Redding never dredged the brook. I don't think he'd left them.
It was always like that.
The previous notice of intent and order of conditions didn't allow them to touch that stream bank. So
that's
what you see is what was there when they previously accepted the created wetland.
So on both sides of the brook, you have two different types of wetland, but you're going to remove the bank on one side, but also it's under an order of condition. The constructed wetland has to maintain its function.
That's right. We can't change the hydrology in the constructed wetland unless we come up with a very good argument as to why it wasn't built according to plan.
But you know you need to do that, so okay.
We know that. We got a lot of work to do. This is not a notice of
intent. Except for the invasive.
Well, there's a little bit of frag in there. Otherwise, it's not a bad one.
If I may just say, just respectfully ask that you do consider, when you're considering your fee, we are trying to make an improvement. We're making a substantial contribution to fund this, not to mention the engineering that went behind it and the different avenues we're going to have to go. And, you know, the center has some vacancy issues which we're trying to improve. So we just respectfully ask that you take that into consideration.
Any other comments from the commission?
No? What are our next steps?
Motion to continue the request for determination. Or we could issue positive determination.
I would move we issue positive determination requiring a notice of intent.
I agree.
We'll calculate and justify a fee and pay that fee.
And then we will either accept that or not.
All right. Sound reasonable to you?
So whatever fee comes in, I accept with the notice of intent application.
Well, no, you hold that fee. Don't cash a check. And we'll discuss it as we look at it and as we look at the project, and we'll make a wise judgment as to whether or not that
we'll pay
fee
the state
or some
fee,
alternative
and we'll hand
fee
you a check for
appropriate.
A local fee.
It just makes me nervous because it sounds like it's going to be
should we start
unclear.
Off with some amount?
Well, I just, whether they give us a check, we're not going to make a decision without a plan, and I don't want to talk about the plan anymore if they're going to be giving it to us in the notice of intent. We should just move on.
Mm-hmm. So just I'm going to put it out there. I'm the applicant. I see this going south, not getting my check.
Wait a minute, what do you,
you're not getting you're not getting a check from me if I know this is going south doing the notice of intent application. So how will we, there's some fee that needs to be paid. It's got to start off with something. I'm asking
well,
you what that fee is.
He'll submit the application with a check.
You want the applicant to come up with his own fee instead of the commission telling him what to pay?
Well, he would submit that, and then we can, looking at the plans, determine if that's too low, too high, or right on. That's totally within our jurisdiction to do. But
just checking.
I think what Brian's saying, and I don't mean to speak for him, is that it's hard to tell what the fee would be unless we have a plan in front of us in a little more detail than what we have right now.
This is a
and
concept,
by
that's all.
Submitting the notice of intent, well, then we'll have that plan. If we say that if he comes in with a fee of $100 and we, in our collective wisdom, say it should be $30,000, they'll probably walk away from the table. That'll be that. We'll be done. That's the way I see the plan.
Rebecca? I just think it's a very uneasy way to proceed. I know this is a new type of permit to consider, and it's, you know, as you were saying, it's kind of a first of its kind. But I don't want to go into a fee negotiating process. I mean, if we have a fee, we should assess that fee.
Do you have a proposal of what the fee should be?
You know, I don't, and I don't have any. I don't have any grounds to say how. To some point, I agree with what you are saying about. $400,000 seems really egregious, but, you know, where's the line between $400,000 and zero? You know, I want to see justification for the fee. I want to see...
I don't think you're going to get that on this one, too.
Right, but I'm saying I don't want to come back and rediscuss the fee without some real reasonable purpose for the dollar value, because I want us to be justified in what we're doing and not simply have an opinion about whether this is fair or right. I want to see real solid backup.
Well, that would be in the notice of intent.
We do have a $700 commercial filing fee. We have an $1,110 cap on your delineation review.
Right.
We have $11 per square foot for any removal disturbance of material. We can calculate those numbers with relative accuracy, and we can propose a fee and justify it on that basis.
If you want to pick what fees you think do apply and what fees you think you want exemption from and why,
mm-hmm.
you know, that is
I
something I can
yeah.
analyze and either agree with or disagree with. You know, and I think that would be, you know, a little bit more solid going forward, because you come before us, others have come before us. I don't want to say, absolutely, let's go to this number without some solid justification and for the sake of consistency for other applicants.
Well, it has to be on a case-by-case basis, and it has
right.
to be a basis for that case-by-case decision.
Exactly.
So we'll give you the case-by-case.
My concern, Anika, is that if he goes through those calculations and gives them to us on a piece of paper that he just described and comes up with a fee of $2,000, and we accept that, and he files his notice of intent, and then we see the plans and the notice of intent, and we say, no, you missed this, you missed that, you missed the other thing. If we ask him to submit the notice of intent along with his fee calculation,
I agree.
We can look at the plan and say, yes, your calculation
yes.
matches the plan, or no, it doesn't.
Right. Then we have a fixed
right.
set of,
yeah.
absolutely.
And you're absolutely
yeah,
right. If the fee goes too high, then we're going to walk away from this, even yeah. having filed the fee and filed the notice of intent.
But we would not cash that check until we agree that that check or some alternative check is acceptable. Because I think we have problems giving the money back.
That would be kind of nuts.
At this point, any questions from the public? Yes. Just for the record, please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Gina Snyder.
Welcome.
I am a volunteer with Walkable Reading. I was at the MAPC meeting and spoke to Jody. And there were some really nice concepts, but a lot of really nice concepts that would help make the parcel more pedestrian-friendly and open it up to people. And I think Jamie mentioned it. I had emailed some people and said, is this even a possibility to use that right away off of Elliott and put a little bridge over so that that entire neighborhood over there would then have pedestrian access? And also I made a comment about the chain link fence and wishing that it maybe could be gotten rid of. So I would love to see those happen. If there's anything I can do or Walkable Reading can do to help with that, or I also have done a lot of volunteer work with the Trails Committee, I'd be willing to even take it to the Trails Committee and ask them for their help. So I'm really hoping, I was very excited at the discussion at the MAPC meeting. It came back raring to go, so I hope
okay.
we'll go forward.
Thanks for your input. Any other questions or comments from the public? No? Okay, do we have a motion for us to either continue or issue a determination?
I think there's a motion to issue a positive determination.
Okay, is it seconded?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
You've got your positive distributed.
That
I think
was,
it's the first person
that was
to
why
thank
I came.
You for a positive determination.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you for the discussion.
That's fine.
Not used to people.
Yeah,
about that. Right.
Because
okay. Okay. Let's move on to the request for determination of applicability 2015-08. For Forest Street and Forest Glen Roadway right away, Boston Gas Company. Thanks for waiting through all this.
Oh,
and
that's okay.
Just introduce yourself for the record.
Sure, I'm Amanda Neville, with Conoco Engineers and Scientists, here on behalf of Boston Gas Company. Boston Gas Company is looking to replace the current old steel gas main in Forest Street, which then crosses into Forest Glen Road. They're going to abandon in place the current steel pipe that's there, and right alongside it install a new plastic pipe along that whole length of the road, basically just to upgrade the system. The steel pipes are old. You know, they're doing this all over the place, so they'll cut and cap both ends of the old pipe. They force an inert gas through it to get, you know, any residual gas out of the pipe. Then they'll cap it, it'll be left in place, and they'll put the new one in.
New one, it'll go right next to the steel pipe?
Right now, yeah, that's the plan. Sometimes it changes. They don't always do the site walk, you know, to see where utilities and stuff are when they send us these projects. So I've had issues where, you know, we go to do the site walk and we have a city engineer or something there. And we're like, oh no, there's utility lines here and there's utility lines here. And sometimes they have to move it based on where other utility lines might be. But as of right now, they're planning to go next to where it currently is. All work is within the roadway. They will cross an existing culvert on Forest Street. The plan right now is to go over the top of that. There should be, based on my knowledge, there should be enough depth of cover to go over that. I think the current pipe goes over it, so there won't be any directional drilling or anything. And then there's a small section of the road that does have some wetlands along it, so we'll be within the buffer zone of that as well. But everything's temporary. They repave. They'll remove any excess soil at the end of every day. So it's pretty, okay.
I've got a question.
Yeah.
Just going forward. I assume you, have you gotten to the end of your introduction?
That's fine. It's pretty,
okay.
Pretty simple.
So the NHESP map in the application shows that there's a vernal pool, looks to be, you know, within 100 feet of the project. Hard to see, but the dot's there.
Yeah.
On the south side of the Forest Street, between Forest Street and the school. Maybe that's Coolidge? Yeah, that's Coolidge. And the track.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
Are there outfalls that are... So you haven't walked the street, so you're not entirely sure how many drains there are outfalls.
I haven't done that.
Okay. Are there any special precautions that you typically take near vernal pools?
We can put up, you know, erosion controls around that if you feel that it's, you know, close enough to where the work is going to be. I'll be honest, in all of the gas projects that I have done, we've actually never come close to a vernal pool.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Typically it's, you know, going over culverts, going past wetlands, ponds, streams, rivers, things like that.
Yeah.
You know, so if you thought that it was particularly close, we can certainly note that. I can tell the crews where it is. We can set up some sort of, you know, control around it just to make sure that it's protected.
Yeah, I mean, typically they do function best during the springtime, you know, and clearly we're past that.
How many feet per day do they do?
It depends on how easy it is to go through. I've seen them do anywhere from 40 feet in a day to 100 feet in a day.
Wow.
Kind of depends on the crew and...
I hope MWRA is listening to that.
How easy it is to, you know, to cut through the pavement. I'm assuming it'll be okay, but as long as it's easy digging, they'll typically, I would say, average is about 60 feet.
Now, are they gonna patch as they go?
Yes. Yep.
So they're gonna cut and then patch
yep,
the same
so
day.
They'll saw cut, they'll do what they're going to do for the day, and then they'll leave a small section unpaved, and they'll put a steel plate over the top of it at the end of every day.
I'm not concerned with the sedimentation.
Okay. Any other questions from commission members? No. Or Chuck, do you have any questions?
No.
Okay. Questions from the public? Okay, hearing none, is there a motion?
So you, just so we're sure, you're okay with no erosion control at all?
a...
No, no, they had proposed erosion control.
I said no. I said I'm not worried about sedimentation and erosion.
But the BMPs are fine. Keep those in?
Yes.
Okay.
Were you talking specifically about additional erosion control about the, around the vernal pool?
I am.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll put silt sacks all along, even when we're not within resource areas,
yeah.
We do that. And then we have some erosion controls around where the wetland area is as well.
Can we do silt sacks with curb inlet protection?
With what?
Curb inlet protection?
Yeah.
What
is that?
Well, they put a silt sack in there and it's got the curb inlet.
Curb inlet in the back, it just
in the back.
Around.
Drop inlet, curb inlet, I don't know.
Yep.
So it really doesn't make any sense unless you have that blocked off too, so that would be great.
I'm not sure the curb's all along the course.
Yeah, sometimes it doesn't happen, but I've been told they're not out there and they are.
Yeah.
So, and they're in the low spot.
Keep it in there just in case.
That's why they need that extra. An extra capacity.
Yeah, there's no point.
Do you guys want to consider a no work during certain rain events, or is this fine?
Ooh, that's right, dewatering.
So they're not going that.
3 to 4 feet.
Really? I hope they're not into water at that depth.
Yeah.
Well, you're going to the same depth of the current existing.
Yes.
Line, right? I mean, it's a replacement, so
yeah, so typically the deepest, especially in a residential area, you'll find wetless pipes is 4 feet.
Yeah.
That's the basic engineering design, is to go down to about 4 feet.
Yeah, there's one.
It wasn't dewatering, it was if it's raining or if it's going to rain, because that's going to be a muddy mess, and that would be a problem. Just something to consider.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a pretty dry year so far, but who's to say what's going to happen? When are you thinking of doing this?
At some time this summer. I don't actually really know.
Okay.
So it probably all depends on when we get the appropriate paperwork and send it over to them. I don't know what other permits they have or don't have. I know they want to get it done this summer.
Yeah. I mean, if they have the appropriate best management practices installed, it should do a fair... It should do its job in stopping the erosion.
Hmm. It's just an added protection in that area where the vernal pool is.
Yeah.
But I'm just throwing
it
out there.
There's also a stream crossing. The road goes over
a culvert.
An intermittent stream.
I think before they proposed to go over a culvert, and then you couldn't, and you had to do directional building.
Yeah, over
so
on Pleasant Street, we had to.
Yeah.
And you would do the same thing, I'm sure, if that happened here.
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm pretty sure this one is fine from my knowledge, but
it's pretty straightforward.
We'll see.
Anything else, Chuck?
That's all.
Okay. Any other questions? No? No questions or comments? Okay. I move we issue a negative determination. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you.
Be drafted and
at the next meeting, we'll be signing.
Yep. Okay. Notice of intent. It's warm in here. We should open the window or something. So at this point, we're now going to open the public hearing for DEP number 270-0647, Oak Street near Oak Ridge Road, roadway right-of-way MWRA. It's now being opened and conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted as follows. The applicant will present his proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. There's an attendance sheet. I know some of you joined a little bit later in the meeting, so there's an attendance sheet in the corner. Please sign in. And Chuck, would you introduce yourself?
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
Okay.
Brian Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Chair.
Jamie Moore.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
Come on.
the area that, well, we'll see what the commission goes, but these areas, is there any other?
No.
I'm Patrick Farrar with the MWRA. With us tonight is actually Mary White with the MWRA, Nick Booth-Lett from FS&T, and Hillary King from FS&T also.
Welcome.
This project, you're aware of West Street, we've been coming through here. The authority is trying to put a loop system in for our northern intermediate high system to be Reading, Wingfield, Wilmington, and Woburn. The next project we have coming out is 8,600 feet of pipe that will connect that West Street portion that's previously been installed through Woburn and continue around on Oak Street, Summer Street, out to Main Street and connect to what was an existing 36-inch connection at the crossing of 128. As part of this project, we have one spot on Oak Street near Oak Ridge where we actually come into a, not in the resource area, but we are within the buffer zone. We will be putting our water line in the blue 36-inch water line, and as part of our project also would be replacing the town sewer and drain lines in this area. Project itself is within the right-of-way. We're not going into the resource areas at all. Standard practices will apply. We'll have sedimentation basins, flock logs for catch basins, silt sacks. We will block off any back drainage on the manholes. That's the limit of our project here.
It's good. Do you guys recognize the spot?
Yeah.
We do. That's the stream where we received the discharge from the dewatering on West Street.
That's right.
Yes, it is.
That is one of the most detailed pictures of that area I think I've ever seen. So, questions from commission members?
So, do you anticipate needing to dewater?
Yes, we do.
And you anticipate a similar design that you had on the West Street dewater?
We expect a similar design.
Hopefully there's not silt in this area too.
Oh, it's going to be everywhere.
That, as we all know, that's a problem.
Yes, we understand that.
Yeah.
And how are we going to make sure those same problems don't reappear?
I think the problems themselves were just operational. The system itself worked. It was just a question of monitoring to make sure it was done appropriately. As part of this project going forward, we will be monitoring daily all the work that goes on in the whole 8,600 feet.
So you said the other one, you determined it was not the design, but the operation that caused the problem.
The existing drain line had a lot of sediment in it.
Yeah.
We did TV it and we did clean it. Mm-hmm. And so when we discharged to that drain line, we pushed a lot of that existing sediment down into the brook.
But there was a lot of silt coming out of that silt bag.
Yes, and we did correct our sedimentation control.
Right. And remind me, how did you correct that problem that we had with all the silt coming out of the bag that was originally designed?
It was a silt sedimentation basin, and there was a silt bag inside the sedimentation. Then there was stone underneath the silt bag, so it had to get that. And then there was a silt fence around the sedimentation tank basin, the hay bale basin. Then, as it got, as the water dispersed from that sedimentation tank, the sedimentation basin, there was flock logs and jute mesh along the catch, along the curb side that would catch the transient silt. It was an anomaly. I mean, we did admit that we kept changing our system trying to capture this. Initially, we went in with a different system, and when we realized how small the sediment was, we kept modifying the system.
Small diameter particles.
And thus we kept modifying the system to try to capture it so that the discharge was clean.
Right, and at the end, after we went through these modifications, you're right, it was pretty clean.
Yeah.
So we're applying. applying those lessons we learned on West Street.
What we did for West Street, Nick Boothlet, design engineer on both projects, the contractor was responsible for submitting a stormwater pollution prevention plan for West Street. So what we basically did is we, through the process that Jerry just outlined, working with a contractor, we came to realize what was the most effective at getting these very fine particles out, including the flock logs and the check dams and the sedimentation basin. And what we did is we created details for that work and actually put it in our contract. So we're not relying on the contractor to submit a SWIP and then maybe applying it and so forth. They actually signed a contract, and we have detail sheets that are, we're a part of the NOI, where we say, you have to put in these check dams. Per the contract, you have to put in the flock logs, because we know that was effective, ultimately, with the West Street project.
What were the frack tanks out there for?
They were down below because you were near that gas station, right?
Yeah, that was
contaminated groundwater. Issue.
But they were further up, too, on West Street.
I think they were just down below.
For one, we got the delivery of the frack tank early. So we put it up on West Street. We put it up at West and Oak Street.
Right.
And they did do some work, excavation there. So they were working through the kinks of the frack tank and just pumping it in there. But a couple days later, that was moved down to the gas station by the Woolburn line.
I see. And I remember seeing it at Oak Street.
Yeah.
It's very effective, but with Oak Street, as you know, the layout, the road layout and the property lines are not very conducive to such a large structure. I think it was 50 feet long.
Yeah.
Long short of lessons learned, West Street will be implemented on this next project.
I presuppose that.
One lesson I think I learned on West Street is that once NWRA got involved, things got a lot better, a lot quicker. So will NWRA still continue to be involved?
Yes. So we'll have construction coordinator on site. Actually, FS&T will be resident, but the authority will have its own resident staff also.
So, excavation activities are going to happen in that road. I'm just sort of talking myself through the process here. These mains are going to be placed and sealed. And where do you anticipate dewatering might be necessary along this reef we're looking at? Reach might need to be dewatered, or what are you expecting?
Of the 8,600 feet, or in this end, for this 200-foot this 200-foot section will require dewatering for the entire 200-foot section. We're deep enough that will happen.
Okay. How deep are you going to be? I don't remember from the pipe.
The bottom of the trench will be close to 11 feet. We have a boring nearby, identified the water at 7, but you can see the brook there. It's not going to be too deep, the water. So depending on the invert of our pipe, which is of course dependent upon utility crossings, the level of dewatering will vary. I can't imagine it will get deeper or worse than West Street at Oak Street, because I think our trench was maybe 16 feet, 17 feet for those blow-off structures. So it won't get deeper than that.
Okay. Did you collect any sediment and like characteristic information from those borings? Do you have some sense of whether it's, you know, sandy or silty? I mean,
yep. You know, the borings have the soil types on them. The level of detail, I'm not sure. I do know the flock logs for the West Street project were designed specifically for that soil. So in theory, we could also write in per the flock log spec that is a requirement.
Good
that
idea.
They choose the flock log with the correct chemistry to deal with that particle.
I remember the check dams and the road and the flock logs in training.
Yep.
Helping that filter out. Are you planning, you know, in case of you know, substantial amounts of pumping, are you planning for provisionally doing some frack tank or needing that?
It depends on where it's needed and how we would pipe to it. It's being considered. To answer the question, yeah, because you don't have a lot of room between the excavation and the discharge for the flock logs and the check dams to do what they need to do. This is the most critical point on the job, I can say, because there's a big electric duct. You know, the road isn't wide as it is. So we need a lot of things to move out of our way. In fact, we've been working really closely with George to Boris and Ryan Percival, because they're getting a lot of new utilities out of this because there's no room to put our pipe. So it just so happens that this area near the drainage is where everything kind of meshes together. Thankfully, things are shallow there because the ground is low, so we don't have to go as deep as maybe some other areas. Like when you come up the corner towards the school, that sewer gets really deep and we have to go underneath sewer services. So we do have that working for us.
So are you going to divert that stream or pump around your excavation?
The stream doesn't, it's not a flow-through stream, I don't believe.
Oh, it doesn't go
I think the drain lines tie into that, supply that.
Oh, so right. The headwaters are the discharge of the stormwater, right?
Yes. Yeah, there's no open water from the north coming through.
It's possible there's some groundwater discharge as well from the surrounding area supporting that east flow.
Yeah. So we're essentially crossing underneath the 24-inch drain that just connects manholes there. It's not an active connected stream.
Questions from commissioners? Chuck, question?
Yeah, the only question is on this discharge area, you don't have it marked on this plan that we're looking at, because I don't see it. And we did have a lot more length to work with, street. So, where are you setting it up? Where's it going?
You mean the detention basin?
The basin, the check dams, the flock logs, the runoff area, all that. Can't go in the street.
What we can do is, the contractor could provide a longer discharge hose on their pump and use the topography there to maybe discharge it to the higher elevations a couple hundred feet away and then install your controls in between. We have that option. So essentially pumping away from the excavation just to come back, because small diameter pump hose is cheap. So that is a possibility.
But you'll close off one lane of traffic in Oak Street and put your detention basin in that closed off lane, I presume.
Yeah, so the layout on Oak Street is actually 50 feet wide, so the property lines are set back quite a bit.
So you think you can put your detention basin outside of the paved area?
That's what they did on West Street at the intersection, and it was well within.
Kind of crept onto the paved section.
Yeah. Well, that was the idea. It would discharge over the curb into the gutter line and then flow. We haven't picked a specific spot for it. I think that would, with your approval, that would be something that we work with the contractor at siting specifically as they moved along, because it will be dynamic as the trench moves.
And Chuck can check that before you finalize your location.
Yeah.
And I'm unlucky enough to drive by there most days, so I can.
I assume it's a full road closure, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's going to be a
full. And also a full pavement restoration.
Full pavement. Oh. Road closure. We've already met.
So I guess I won't be driving by.
It's going to take a while. We're doing a lot of work in the street.
That's a big pipe.
So is next, you'll be working all next summer? Is that your plan?
Two construction seasons. We've not limited the contract at this point to where he starts or where he finishes.
But are you not going to start this summer, are you?
No, we expect notice to proceed in September. So I suspect next spring is when you start to see the meat of the construction.
I'm telling you, Shortest Street, Two Points of Reading is going to be always under construction the next few years. Yeah, it's not going on anywhere.
It's going to be to go up to 495 and go back down.
Okay. Any other comments or questions or concerns from commission members? Okay. Hearing none. Questions, comments? Nothing. No more discussion. Okay. Motion to close the hearing.
Chuck, can you order conditions by 2 weeks? Or do you want some more time?
I'll get this one. We didn't do the other one, so I don't have one to do yet. So.
Okay. So I move the closed hearing.
All those in favor?
Okay. And then I'll move we issue our conditions based on the plans that submitted.
Sorry. All those in favor? Okay, thank you.
That was too easy.
I know. Thank you for your notes and coming in.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. Our last time to agenda meeting before the evening is the request for determination of applicability for 132 Grove Street. Map 32, lot 54, Jeff B.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you very much for having me.
You can give the green cards to Chuck if that's what you're...
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, thank you, board members. We purchased a property at 132 Grove Street in Reading, and our inspector and Jamie had come out Monday night for a site visit. I had met with Chuck out there on another occasion. And pretty much it's just, I brought some photos and stuff for you. There's just, it's just overgrown and trees and bushes. Just overgrown all over the property. It hasn't been taken care of in 4 or 5 years. And we're just looking to clean up some trees that are dead, fallen trees, a lot of brush that's, you know, there's a removal of 5 or 6 trees that are no larger than 6 inch in diameter that are currently dead as they stand or close to it. So that's basically...
Okay.
There's some trees out in the front that we had spoke of possibly if my budget allows me to remove those. They're favoring the street side. You know, for additional parking, there's, you know, it's kind of crammed up Grove Street right where the parking is. So there's a lower level that it's about 35-foot area. That's in a lower level that we've agreed to, you know, the leaf coverage there now. Just basically take the brush and stuff out. And leave the leaf cover as it, you know, currently is. We'll just, you know, remove it so we're not interfering with any of the conservation areas.
Okay. So
I'm not digging up any streets or anything, so it's not too tough.
Yeah. Gotcha.
The side yard, it's just, I noted on the left side yard here, they're just like 1 inch trees. It's just like brush.
Yeah.
This is actually that area right there.
Okay. So, are you proposing to do any loaming and seeding?
No, the top.
At this point?
At the top section, this is about
grass.
8 feet below grade. We just like to hide and seed up there, the side yard, side of the house, over here, and then just clean up over here. Just a little hide and seed on the upper level. This bottom level is leaf cover now, Jamie, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
It's all leaf cover now.
Okay.
This access to conservation, which we cut, we take some of the debris.
Okay, and the resource area is over here?
No,
it's
back.
Right there.
Okay, gotcha.
So we kind of leave all this, the natural state it is now, except for removing some of the, you know, the dead trees and brush and stuff that are in here. We'd hide the sheet up, you know, the top area. It's about 7 foot elevation over. You know, it's a natural hill now. We'd like to try to leave the integrity of that if we could.
So at this point, you're not proposing to replant any additional trees or shrubs or anything?
No, we had talked about possibly doing something, you know, later on, but we after talking with them, we, you know, the leaf cover and leaving it.
Yeah, there's a bush on the story in there.
Yeah.
I do think it makes sense for you to flag those trees and have Chuck take a quick look before you actually come down.
Yeah, absolutely.
Make sure the ones you're cutting and the ones we're talking about.
Yeah, absolutely.
Were there trees that you discussed at the site visit that you agreed
they were, but
cut down?
But Becky and I were pretty wimpy. We didn't go all the way back down there.
There's a lot of poison ivy stuff in the channel.
But we were able, the deck extends out to the end of that drop, so you can stand on that deck and you can see pretty well. But we didn't go right there and touch all 10 or 8 of those trees.
There's 7, and there's none of them any bigger than 6 inches, and they're currently dead with no branches on them. Nothing that's, you know, that's aesthetically...
There are a couple of elms that aren't going to live much longer anyway.
Okay. So, based on the site visits, what's your opinion about these trees?
Just the only thing, that you just flag them and have Chuck look at them before you actually cut them down.
And I think getting a lot of the dead log and track, some yard debris in there, it's going to take all that out.
What's Chuck looking at the trees for?
Just to make sure that the ones that we think are going to be cut are actually the ones that are going to be cut. We've had problems in the past where somebody went a little wild with chainsaw.
No, I would take anything down that you and I, that we didn't discuss on the site visit, I promise. But if Chuck has spare time, I'd more than happy to.
Is it going to be clear based on this plan, or is Chuck going to go out and go, well, this could be any...
I do want to try to understand what you two who saw the plan and met with gentlemen to what you are expecting, because I was there too, and it's an overgrown, it's been overgrown for 20, 30 years, something like that.
Right.
And from what I know about this project, he's going to turn that entire tiered level all the way down to the well and back into lawn.
No,
we decided to get
that plan.
That's
the
gone.
Top section is lawn. The top section will be lawn. The bottom area is just going to stay, just going to stay natural leaf cover. And
except for removing four trees from that bottom section.
Right.
And
they're currently gone.
Trees there. Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
top
he
section.
He was going to leave the leaf litter on this. You know how this is steep.
Yep.
And then it flattens out, and then it goes down into
yep.
the skunk cabbage. That part that's kind of flat. He's going to remove those fallen down trees
mm-hmm.
to this side, and then that's this area. He's just going to leave the leaf litter. And you were going to hydroseed this
the
piece?
Top portion.
The top
portion.
The
up under the deck where we were in the side yard. Remember on the left
okay,
there?
Okay, on this side. But
yes.
Then this piece from here to here, you're going to leave.
We're going to leave all of this area here. Will be left natural. This will be hydroseeded. And this is the left side. Back under the deck.
Underneath
yes,
here, hydroseeded.
Right, yeah.
But this would not be. This is a very steep.
Right, the hill will be nothing. Nothing will be done to the hill. It'll stay all natural leaf cover
so,
and the bottom section
so
will all
you know
stay.
What I'm talking about? The
I am, but we can't do it like this on this project. I think that you're going to have to modify your plans. You know, whether we close tonight or not, but I'm going to need to see what he's doing, and then I'll send it out to you guys, and you guys will agree or not before I sign off on the building permit. I just there's too much things happening. I just want him to write down on, even on the plan that he submitted, this section stays, this section hydroseeds, this section, and then everyone looks at it, and then I can keep him to a plan, but I can't keep him to what you've told me, because I might have a different perception of it.
Do you understand that?
To some degree. I have no problem going along with whatever you guys so choose. We met, I will do it. Like I can meet you out there at another time and more than happy to go over the plan with you.
No, draw a plan up and
yep.
submit it, and I'll submit it to the commission
okay.
and they'll, and that's not gonna interfere with the permit.
Okay, so my concern
if
is-
if you get it.
Yeah. My concern is, the building permit. The construction I'm not in any violation of being in the back area, correct? Is that?
I'll sign off when I get the plan, so you can start making your plan
okay.
Tonight if you want.
Yeah, fine. I'll be in tomorrow.
I think it might be more helpful if you use that plan.
Enlarge
the plot plan.
It didn't show the hill roll, that's why
the what?
It didn't show the grade.
Well,
so
you can make the pencil
yeah,
that.
Yeah, okay.
You
all right, I'll pass it in. Yeah.
And just,
yeah.
And just write the pencil in your
yeah.
wetland line
yeah.
like you did, the bottom of that hill,
yeah.
and then just point an arrow and write, these trees to be removed, mark them.
Uh-huh.
And leaf litter and ground cover to remain.
Okay, very good. I'll come in tomorrow for a better plan. Sure.
Okay, and might one of you, I mean, you went on the site visit, so you seem to understand the plan, so might one of you be available to review that with Chuck, or at least...
I'll just scan it and send
questions.
It out. You can
yeah.
make comments
okay.
like you do on the... orders.
Okay.
Print it out. Thank you very much.
Let me see. This was
okay.
this a request for determination?
Yeah. He's jumping the gun.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. It is a request for determination.
Okay. Well,
yeah. So.
I'm not sure everybody's comfortable with this inside, but I would move that we issue a negative determination to contingent on submission of the plan as described and acceptance by the administrator.
Okay, I'll second that. All those in favor? Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yep,
all right,
thank you.
I actually prepared something because I knew the gentleman was in a rush.
Okay.
He's a good guy.
I don't want to hold him up, but I do want that plan because
yeah,
it's needed.
We do need a plan. We need to
right.
see exactly what's happening where
just
so that we know
the
exactly what we're
commissioner's information. The next door neighbor, or actually I guess it's two neighbors down, in that flat area has put in a swimming pool, a yard, a fence, and God knows what else. So, I don't know if we approved it or not. I guess we probably did.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, do you?
Okay. No?
Oh, that's what the
name is.
Okay, old new business. Thank you for waiting around a little bit longer. Let's get to Haleakala West Street and Oak Street enforcement closeout. Did I say that right?
Haleakala?
Yep.
Haleakala.
I'm Corey Barrett with the MWRA. I'm the director of construction. You already met Nick and Mary.
Yep.
And then Jerry Sheehan, our construction coordinator. Jerry and Mary have been working with Chuck and submitted the removal of the environmental controls at Oak Street, the plan. And so at this point, we're back for closeout of the enforcement.
Okay. And you submitted to us the removal of environmental controls. Oak Street.
Yeah, and that was done.
Was there a site visit that was done?
I conducted
a
site visit,
did?
And I talked to our on-site monitor, which was the gentleman that lives at 62 Oak Street, Barb Carboni. He's been in front of the commission before. So I wrote you an email.
And you said everything was done?
I thought it was fine. I thought,
yeah.
Again, as soon as the MWRA got involved, things got better quickly.
Yes.
And that even included when I raised a concern about how the silt fences would be taken out of the stream because they were holding back sediment. They came up with a plan to take care of that, so no issues. Everything was taken seriously.
Okay.
Worked out well.
Thank you for all your effort on this. I don't see have any objection to closing out the enforcement order. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you very much for
thank
all
you.
Your effort
thank
and
you.
And attention to
it. Coming out there in February.
So I did prepare a letter, but I
okay.
First time I put my name on it instead of yours because you always tell me to put my name on it. So you can't sign it this time.
That's in the other house. We got all kinds of stuff done.
Good night.
Good night.
Making our meeting short.
How is it done?
Thanks for your help. Hey, Chuck, are there any minor projects?
No. Well,
okay. Yes, no.
Let me just come back to it. I refresh my memory on it.
Can we work it into the agenda?
Sure.
All right.
Okay, 20 seconds.
I need the 20.
Well, first of all, let's do that minor project.
No, let's not. Let's
no
do the 20. Do the 20.
What's your business?
This is just, I belong to the Wildflower Society, and they send out this newsletter. And one thing this newsletter pointed out were habitats at risk or in danger, and they point to rivers and streams, and they point to red maple swamps as a resource that is decreasing in quantity and in quality. I meant to bring it up in relation to.
What are the stressors though? What would cause the
invasives and clearing of land.
Okay.
So I was surprised that he said red maples he considered invasive because they do keep some of the other things active if they're healthy. But anyway, just for your information.
Okay. Well, feel free. Is that any of that available online?
Are
you able
is.
To just?
Probably.
Okay. New England Wildflower Society. Okay.
So.
Go ahead.
Do you have to? I don't know if there's an introduction needed for me. But
we know who
this
you
is
are.
Chuck Turan,
he identified himself.
I mean, for my fan base out there in So you told me once before, don't bring minor projects to you that I thought completely qualified. I have one here that I don't think we need to talk about. It's some sonotubes 80 feet away, but I have one I'm concerned about, and I'm not sure if the commission should look at this. This gentleman here, we permitted him for a fence.
Where are we? That's
we're on 28 Summer Street.
House. I know that house.
28.
Oh, this is 26
yeah.
Summer Ave.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where do house. We know that house?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
oh,
so.
Oh, oh, I know.
What ended up happening in town hall was the gentleman came in, or his contractor came in.
Who is the gentleman? Is it Fergoni?
Yeah.
I remember.
Yeah.
So,
it's a good amount.
Permit came in with for an electric permit, and the electrical inspector issued the permit. Then everyone started noticing there's an electrical permit on the site, and you know, he comes in for a building permit after the fact, and then they say, well, why don't you talk to conservation? So what's going on out there and done at this moment, but almost completely done at the time when they were getting permits, was we have a patio out there, and we have a sauna and electricity inside the fence, which you permitted on existing lawn. So there's a fence right here, right at the edge of the lawn.
I remember the fence, yeah.
And this is going right in this area here.
So it's not the property in yellow. It's the one.
No, it's this one here.
It's in the back.
Who is this owner?
Well, that's that Fergoni.
It's Forstall,
yes,
yeah.
Front.
Forstall.
Yeah, but he developed it.
Right.
Yes.
So he wanted to do a minor project permit. For this project.
So after the effect.
So just measuring off of what we work with here.
That's a stream, is it not?
It is the Arbejana River.
But it's upstream of MBTA. It's not. It's intermittent, is it not?
It's not.
It's not
a river.
Right.
Not a riverfront.
Okay.
So we're not worried about the riverfront.
Okay.
I have to do this because when I change maps, it disappears.
Oh. The channel's there.
So maybe.
Well, who knows where the channel is? I wouldn't trust that.
There's the house, the corner of the house. He's probably working in this area here,
so
inside the fence.
Inside the fence, existing.
Inside
lawn.
His fence. I mean,
existing lawn.
Existing lawn.
If I remember, that fence is within a few feet of the wetland bank.
So.
Well, that's not what shows on this plan, but
so
if it is.
So the
work he's doing is
from that stream, which is a data layer from DEP.
He's excavating. Is this just a shed on
shallow
buildings?
Excavation? Probably take off the first layer and then sand and compact it, and then I don't know what it is using.
But he's just putting
yeah, probably blocks. Per,
he's just putting in a post to put a light on, right?
No. He's doing a patio, like 25 by 25, but it's blocks, you know, I can't think of the name of it.
Pavers,
yeah. And then it's got that, it's got the sauna on it.
For what?
Oh,
it's like a sauna, like a hot tub.
Oh, no,
like a sauna, hot tub.
A hot tub,
yeah. So.
Is that, because I was thinking like a cedar room with heated
sauna.
Okay.
So, anyways, this one was not as cut and dry. The project's finished. When he came in,
The wetland extends way up on where that stream shows.
Really? I know it does on the other side. I remember on the other side.
We need to go back to the original file because we spent a lot of work and time and money and pain to delineate that wetland.
And it went all the way around the house?
It was on the other side.
I know it was to the right of the driveway.
Close to the line. I thought that has was just barely 35 feet past the line.
I'm pretty sure the bounds I remember seeing were on the right side of the house.
Yeah.
Those are the only ones that I looked at on the site.
But we did allow that fence. I mean, a fence isn't...
We allowed the fence, but we allowed it inside the 35-foot zone, I'm pretty sure. Pretty sure we did. Because, you know, it was a fence and it created a barrier, so we didn't get a lot of junk in the wetland. So, but we need to go back and check that wetland.
Should I this on a site visit to look that closely?
Well,
we would need a plan anyway.
Send you the plan, and then we'll make a decision. Okay.
And that he should get the plan with the wetland line.
We should have it. I can contact him for the plan.
This was during my tenure, so it's got to be less than 6 years old.
It would be good to have a site visit, I think.
They put the foundation in, and then they got a stop work order. That foundation sat there empty for a decade because it was in violation of the wetlands. And they came back and finally got the permit after
10 years. Do you remember the second means of access?
They had second means of access. They had to have...
It's on Willow Street.
Actually, they put a conservation.
Yes. Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, they put a conservation restriction on that land.
This is that property.
This might be a violation of the conservation restriction. I doubt it, but
the attorney was
aggressive.
Oh, everyone.
Yeah, but if it's on existing lawn, it wouldn't be in violation of the conservation restriction, unless there's some impervious cover limit.
You're probably right. It might be in the top 35 feet.
That'll all be in the file. If it's outside of 50 feet, I don't need to see it.
I don't know if we know until we see the map. And
that's
we do a site visit.
Yeah, I agree with that.
But that's what I'm saying. If it's outside of 50, I don't need a site visit.
If it's inside
no, that's clear. That's a minor, could be a minor permit. Now, another thing that's very confusing about this is, the sauna or the hot tub requires a building permit. But the structure it's sitting on, the paver patio, does not.
Hmm.
And we fall into this a lot in conservation. A lot of the contractors out there don't think any permit's needed because a building permit's not needed for such a thing.
For a patio, right?
For a patio.
Right.
Well,
it's kind of like landscaping. Sort of, it's in that category. They'll use it for like 2 months and then they'll never use it again.
I don't know what.
Rotting underneath? I don't know.
I might be wrong. Maybe that doesn't need it either. I'm not sure.
Oh,
you know?
Mean the building permit for the probably just for the electrical hookup, I would think, to run the electrical.
Well, it did get an electrical permit. I'm not sure if it needs a building permit. I don't know. I'll take that back.
I don't think you need a building permit for a hot tub. I mean, it's pretty bad. It's too much dumping on it.
Right. Do you need a building permit for a pool?
Yeah, you do.
Yes, good prevention.
Maybe it's in the rules.
Could be.
I don't think you have to put a fence around a sauna, though. I mean,
no,
I
don't.
What's the difference between a big high tub and a small pool?
Yeah.
Well, you can have one of those things.
Oh,
you can lock the cover.
After the kid falls in, you put the cover over his
life. There any stuff?
Let me take you to one more. What happened to that?
It's right down the street from me.
It is, and as a matter of fact,
Well, not right down the street.
Yeah, probably definitely out of eye.
40 B.
I hope
that's not the Humpty Dumpty school. No, that's further down.
Do I have the
house? I know that house. Yeah, there's Bond Street right there.
Where's Bond Street?
Right, it's right to the right there, Bond Street.
Yeah, this is the guy over here. Remember this thing here?
Yeah, he's still
being funny over there. Trees have been falling all over the place. Well, the trees that he girdled.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so what's going on with that property?
He built a shed on Cosmos, not wetlands, land we own. And he took the trees of the wetlands and cut them down.
I think it's the neighbor that does a fantastic landscaping out there.
Is the shed?
No, the one next to him.
No, I mean that red.
Okay. This is 258 Lowell Street. It's the merchant's house. And the other day I drove past on my way home and there was a section of the gate removed. And I looked inside and there was a backhoe and a hole in the ground.
Really?
So I know this house. I've talked through email to the merchants. April 2014, they want to install a basketball hoop. I tell them it's going to be difficult. They're within the 25-foot ZNV, even though it's existing law and a permit's needed. Another email, I explained our regulations, section 3D, 2 and 4. You can't do this without a permit. And then I said, if you want to get the process rolling, never said no. I reviewed this and never said no, but you need to file a permit, okay? And so it looks like pretty much in April 16th, she's decided that she needs a permit, and maybe it's not something that can't get permitted. So this is going to be a sports court. With basketball, something like that. I drive past the other day, see this thing happening, shoot her an email. Yes, they're moving forward without a permit. They're moving forward without a permit. This is actually the first day of construction, so it was, my full-time hours that allowed me to do this, right? No, but it was. But anyways, I called them. I went there, and I explained to them that. You know, not only the fact that I sent you the emails, but you know, this just can't happen. We gotta talk about this. Apparently, the contractors convinced them that if they used pervious surfaces, and the fact that the building department didn't need a permit, that this wouldn't be needed a permit from conservation. So this is what they're telling me. So for those two reasons, they moved forward. With this project.
Even after you told them several times that they need a permit.
No, it's quite clear.
Yeah, well, that's what it sounds like to me.
But, you know, we're out there.
How much work has been done?
First day. They dug a hole, they kind of moved dirt to the side.
How deep?
At the most, it's 20 inches. At the other side, it's less. It's within 16 feet, plus or minus 3-4 feet of the wetland. On existing grass lawn.
How big is that? I'm sorry.
It's probably 16 by 20. It's going to be 16 by 20.
That's pretty big.
Yeah, they're outside the aquifer protection district, so it's not a factor in this.
That's almost the size of this room. Half the size of this room.
I'm tempted to say we should issue an enforcement order.
Did I say 16 by 20? The original, they'd like a court 25 by 25. So this is what my April 2014 email says. I'm assuming they're going with that.
Did you issue a stop work?
I didn't issue a stop work because these two people answered my email right away, met me on the site, and I told them not to do any work and come into town hall and let's see what's happening here. They have gone forward and submitted a request for determination for applicability and said they wouldn't move forward on this project until the commission reviews it.
Oh, okay. So they did. They have stopped work.
They've stopped work and they've taken that step.
Yeah. Okay.
And we have that in town and we'll be seeing it at our next meeting. My question to you guys is that seems enough?
It's It's not a minor permit, I can tell you that.
No, it's definitely not a minor permit.
Yeah, it is a, who, was it you that told me? Someone told me that it was a pervious surface basketball court. It's fairly expensive.
I imagine it's more expensive than
you can use overgraded.
So anyways, well, I said that because they did take that step to, from what they heard and tried to, you know, make it work as best as it could.
So once you showed up, there's some voluntary compliance.
Exactly.
Is that, so does this fall under conversion of lawn to accessory use?
Yeah.
So I think.
But it's within the,
it's within what distance?
The 25-foot no disturb zone.
I know,
it's
already
disturbed.
It's disturbed.
Well, yeah, but lawn is a lot different than the basketball court.
Well, wait a minute. You talk about, now you're talking about a pervious surface. They use a pervious surface.
Right, as long as it's
lawn is
pervious
surface.
Lawn is pervious.
Yeah, I'm not sure if you're going to argue that lawn is habitat.
And let me tell
sure
you something,
that
if they're fertilizing that lawn, you're better off with the
hand. I mean, if
what you're saying is somebody can pave their yard right up to the
That's the question we're asking.
That would be a disaster. I don't care how
right.
pervious it is. That would be a disaster. They made that whole lawn.
Well, if it's pervious, it's not impervious.
Yeah, but pervious is, how long is it really pervious? I mean, it's less than concrete, but it's not like grass.
Okay.
All right.
All right,
something
so we're
going to
see
about.
That in the next.
Yeah, I was going to try to show you pictures, but I can't.
Drainage concrete is nice. Yeah. Pervious concrete is actually great.
Okay. So let's move on to a couple of orders of conditions. How about that? Like Sturgis Park?
Sturgis Park?
That is not Riverfront. Who asked the question?
Okay, so.
I said it wasn't, but I wanted somebody to confirm that you
could. Are there any.
It's under a mile, it's under a square mile.
I forgot one at home, but on the first page, there's a description of the gentleman who owned it, Sturgis. And it was spelled S T E R G E S.
Yeah.
Is it S T U?
Yeah,
S T U?
I flagged that too. I don't know.
I made some changes in revision mode. I think I sent them to everybody.
No, that didn't get through. That's still on there.
Today.
Do you still have them? I'm tempted to put a ban on Wednesday emails because just it's really hard to print things out last minute and be reviewed and prepped for the meeting. From applicants emailing things.
I was sending out Monday and Tuesday, so you got some Monday and you got some Tuesday.
So I printed something out, and I don't think it had the changes, Jamie, that you had in it. There was another, it was 70 Lawrence. You put changes on 70 Lawrence, but I don't think you put changes. You did.
It doesn't come up on this.
I know the change that made the minutes, I think.
You didn't?
And you didn't bring them tonight?
No.
So.
There were only four or five.
There was a couple, actually, I can remember them. You wanted to take out the riverfront. And you requested that there would be a conscious effort not to get sediment into the stream.
Right.
And you said no woody vegetation.
I forgot about the two.
Except for the.
Yeah, but you modified that.
And you were okay with that. So.
And there were a couple typos.
And there was like a typo or so. And there's one more that Sturgis, Mr. Sturgis. I'll fix that.
Yeah. And
that was pretty much it.
There was one that the sentence that didn't make sense that I said.
Right, I have that highlighted right here.
I'm not sure I got the right word in there. But.
Yeah, I don't have any objections to those changes. Does anybody else
have
any?
Do you have them? Do you have the email?
I have your email, but it doesn't show up with track changes.
Well, if you go up, you might have to change.
Well, no, this is an old. No, this is.
This is just how it looks. This is just a preview.
You don't get the real thing?
This isn't, no. This
so you changed leases to leased. You changed, you asked me a question about the culvert conveying the stream underneath the...
Yeah, that was just intense change.
Yeah, that was the first one. And then you said the culvert conveys the stream underneath the stream, put a question mark, but it was just kind of explaining what's going on. Maybe it went...
You said the culvert, say it again.
The culvert conveys the stream under South Street.
Right.
Is that the change I made, or is that...
Well, you just put a question mark.
But it does.
Oh, the question mark was, I don't think the culvert is land underwater. That was the question. I think if the stream's in a culvert, I don't think it's land underwater.
It is?
Yeah. And it's banked?
Not necessarily. If the annual high water...
But it could be.
No, it can't be banked. Well, it can be if it's the boxer culvert, because there's a bank in the culvert. Above
mean
annual high water.
All right, so I'm lost. Why are we talking about bank in the culvert? There's no work going on in there.
Yeah, well, I think you said that.
It's just identifying the resource areas.
I don't think the culvert is a resource area. It was mine, but I'm not sure.
So it was in the findings. A perennial stream flows southward within the lot, parallel to the east side of the line. The stream is a tributary to the Abajona River. A culvert conveys the stream under South Street.
It's considered land underwater for calculations for a 4-1 quality. For instance, if it's under a bridge, it's...
Oh, I know
water.
If it's under a
right.
bridge,
but
it
in
is.
A culvert.
Oh, it's over. Sure. Right, it doesn't matter.
So
I think these are...
I was going to propose at the end of that paragraph there, that finding, that I was going to propose this sentence. This stream does not have a watershed size large enough to qualify this reach as a riverfront area. Mm-hmm.
Did you measure it?
You know that...
George did.
George,
I think you're right. I think he told us.
He did tell us. And what we inherited.
Okay, then we should say that he told
according
us
to the
that.
Town engineer.
And he checked it again. But I checked back two permits, and they called it a perennial stream. So
for what work?
It's easy enough to look up.
Yeah, I'll have to look it up again. I don't know. What was it for?
Okay.
I know when we put that top lot in there, it wasn't, we said that's not...
No, that was recent. This
yeah.
was all the things that... The
since
top
I've
lot...
Since I've been here, we've never permitted anything in Sturgis Park. The top lot was the first thing.
I might have been looking at something else. So you want to say something about George Zambrero's... George and Watershed. Okay.
Do you want me to repeat the sentence, or...?
No, I can come up with something.
Okay. I also thought
understand what you mean.
We were missing a document, the May 6, 2015 Reading Engineering Memo that included the stream bank restoration plan by WPI. Did I just miss that in the documents, or that seemed like a big one?
No, the supplemental memo on December 3rd.
Right, but we had a May 6 memo with the planting stream bank restoration program. The Sturgis Park.
Okay.
I mean, that has even this lovely little thing at the board. One of the findings that says all of the proposed work is on page 2, like the second paragraph, all the proposed work is located in the resource area and buffer zone instead of riverfront area, of course.
Which one was that? What finding was that? Yeah, we have that. All work. So number 6, all the proposed work is located in the resource area.
Okay. And that's all I have. Anything
for anyone else? I have a couple others, but I think Jeff has.
If you,
we
went off yours. So if everybody accepts Jamie's changes, then plus what Anika has added to this, we're
I agree. Motion to issue as amended tonight.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor? All right.
There you go.
Okay. The other order of conditions
70.
Is 70 Lawrence. You don't need to talk about town plan.
Ready? I'm not going to throw this at you. I guess.
Okay.
I see changes. They are all
those are yours.
Oh. How did you get that?
Printed it. That one I printed.
But it doesn't show the changes, does it?
I actually, I printed out the changes on this one.
Oh, and you distributed
for some reason
really
I was a lot more on top of it for this. Here's the only one that I want to talk about, since you guys are pausing, is the first one that Jamie proposed. This is number two, and he says the proposed project is to construct an addition in an existing house, which is, this is what he added, which is outside the buffer.
I need to check. I didn't explain this one. It's not?
No. Okay.
So that patio is within the buffer zone? I mean,
there's a portion of the house. You can see the line cut right through a portion of the addition.
Okay.
That's in it. And I think I have it here in color.
No, I didn't have the plan in front of me.
Oh, so.
Refer to somebody who was looking at the plan.
So. Okay.
And.
Oh, you have a plan right here.
Yeah, I do. So I had some edits to the findings.
Oh, you're right. The 100-foot, the addition is just barely in the buffer
zone. Just barely
in
the house.
Okay, so that means the patio is within the buffer zone also.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll have to adjust my comment accordingly.
Okay. I had a finding, I thought it was important to put in there that any soils excavated during installation of the pool will be used west of the pool, graded and stabilized so as not to cause erosion and sediment deposition into the wetland.
That's not a finding. I think we already have that in the list of conditions.
A3,
is it?
At the last page, but not on copies most members have, because it also added at the last minute.
Yeah, I didn't have A3.
Right, it was Jamie's. Jamie's thought about this, and he said,
okay.
All excavated material will be either used as part of the landscaping construction on site, the 100-foot buffer line on site, outside the 100-foot buffer line, or transported immediately off site.
We need to adjust that because we know it will be used within the 100-foot buffer zone now. So it will be used as landscaping on site in the outer buffer zone. It's fine.
One other edit I had was, I don't know, for me it's the third page, no, fourth page, halfway down. It says the owner and all future owners not cut healthy native trees, paragraph. But it says, what I wanted to change was the wording, instead of footprint of the new structure, just put the word house, so I'll reread the sentence. The owner of all the future, and all future owners cannot cut healthy native trees with a DBH greater than 4 inches between the house and the wetland resource area.
Well, the house, it is part of it, that's out of buffer zone.
Right, but if we, instead of house, we would say footprint of the new structure. That's too vague. We have a pool, we have decking, so which new structure are we talking about?
Footprint of the proposed new structure.
Which new structure? Though that this, I mean, if, or the house, like, you know, are we gonna start no cutting from here to the wetland or from the house to the wetland? I would say from the house. Because new structure, he's putting a new structure here, so which new structure? Do you know what I mean? It's just me.
I know what you mean.
It seems vague to say footprint of the new structure. So instead of footprint of the new structure.
Footprint of the addition.
So do you just want to, I mean, I just wanted to be general so that we could capture as many trees that they want to cut as possible. So I was thinking just, you know, the house limit is going to include that addition.
Well, we can change it on this one, but change it back for the next one. I mean, usually it works.
Yeah.
So you want to try to grab everything in the 100-foot buffer zone? I thought we were really only trying to grab something between 35 feet and
I would say in the pool in the resource area.
Yeah.
Do you have any objections to that, Brian, Rebecca? No? There's no trees there anyway. All right, so between the pool.
Oh, yeah. Are they trees?
We can do.
Yeah, but I mean between there.
Right.
Yeah, that was all along. Okay.
I guess it's true. Yeah.
Okay, Chuck, so I guess that's it. Otherwise, motion to approve as amended tonight.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Yeah.
Which one is this?
I think it's Sturgis.
Yeah, Sturgis is out there.
Okay.
So in the dead space, can I bring up something else while you're signing?
Yeah. Did we already take care of 16 Joseph?
No.
No.
Yes. Oh.
We did?
No.
Okay, yeah, I think we did.
Well, if it's
I crossed it off. Did we?
Yeah, I think we did.
I think we did.
Make sure.
Check. There's signature.
16 Joseph is right here and signed.
We signed it? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So,
you ready?
Now.
I have something else. I just need a point of clarification from the commission. 306 Main Street and the request to waive the fees on the new permit because he paid him on the old permit.
Wait a minute, which one?
That's
306.
Yeah, 306. He's Brandon Simpson. And he shot me an email, and I was wondering what that said.
The back goes sitting there for 2 weeks. And I've seen it do.
I thought they were being stored from another project.
They're probably being stored from the wildlife project there.
Yeah.
I don't know. He's just he's explaining what I already knew. Okay. So here's the thing. When we waive the fees, my understanding of it, we were waiving the town bylaw fees. Were we waiving all fees, which would include the state, our side of the state Wetlands Protection Act fees? Have we done that in the past? And I think that was my confusion. I don't remember ever giving back that side. We looked to the minutes and it said give the fees back. We looked to his request, which said can you waive the fees? But he didn't specifically say which fee.
So refresh my memory. He filed a permit, and then he didn't think he had enough money to build what CDC.
I don't know what the reason was, but he did withdraw, and he did send.
Did we give him his money back?
No.
No.
No. On that one we were well into it. Then he. I don't know what happened, but anyways, he filed again, and he asked me what I thought, and I said, well, you should just pay the fees and then ask for a variance. And so he did, but he asked for this variance, and I think, again, we're back to my interpretation. The commission thought that he shouldn't pay twice. Pam Merrill said...
Who?
Oh.
Pam Merrill said that she would not waive in the state fees. All right.
Fees don't get waived.
So that's, I thought that was our side too. I don't think the commission has ever waived the state fees, but I need to let Brandon know, and I told him I'd bring it up to you.
How much is the state fee? 700?
No, he was total of like 16 something, and it was 1,000 something for the bylaw fee, and the state side, our side of the state fee was about 500 something, 534 or something like that.
I don't know if we can waive that either, right?
I didn't have enough time to look into it because it really kind of built up steam today.
Yeah.
And I looked on the website, MACC, to see if anyone else had this question before, and about that's as far as I got to it. But I did check the minutes. I did check his variance request, which wasn't very specific, and neither were the minutes. to tell, to direct me in what we had actually agreed. And we looked, and I pulled out Camp Curtis Guild, and that's why I knew those numbers tonight. And we only waived a portion of the fees.
Well,
so it wasn't
helpful either.
Camp
Curtis Guild was different.
Yeah, but they didn't withdraw.
No, it was. I was just thinking that if we waived both sides, then I would have an example.
Well,
I thought I tried to talk them into not withdrawing it.
I'll tell you, they give the town a check for our portion of that fee, right?
Mm-hmm.
They hand you a check. You can hand it back to them and say, "You're all set. You already paid last time."
That's not where we're at. That's not where we're at. Did we waive that side of the fees or not? I mean, you're right. We have total control over that.
We can give them that check. We don't have to take that.
Yeah, we have
payment. DEP can't. We can't tell them.
Oh, the state actually gives us a check?
No.
No, we get the check.
The applicant gives us
a check. They mandate we get a check.
They give us three checks. One for the bylaw, one for the state, one for tenant's portion.
No, the state
gets
the
state. It goes to a lockbox.
So the state, so he writes two checks.
Yeah.
Yes.
Correct.
One that's for the state, one that's for tenant's portion of the state
Correct.
Permit plus the bylaw.
Correct.
Okay. So we can waive our portion of the state.
We can't waive the state payment that goes to the state.
Because it never came to us.
That's correct. We never see it.
I don't think he's asking for that.
Right.
I'm good with waiving
that. I'm good with waiving that.
The guy's been beat around pretty badly, and we'd like to get that site cleaned up.
He's a simple pizza guy.
And we'd like to get that site cleaned up. Sitting around.
Right.
He's not listening.
Right. Well, that's what he says, you know.
Oh, is that what he says? Oh, then that's fine.
I'm a simple pizza guy.
Just for the sake of the record, what were the numbers for that again? So the state got...
I have it right here. Hold on a second. All right, so here we go. 1,679.58 came in. Out of that, bylaw generated $1,142.08, and the state Wetlands Protection Act generated $537.50.
But we're really not waiving the fee. We collected that the last time he filed. He paid it.
He paid it.
Right.
Then he withdrew his application.
Yes.
I want to do business with every single one of you guys someday. just saying.
I mean...
But no, I get it. I just want to know what you want to do. It was my... I don't care. Come back. You give him back his money. That money is fine.
Give him back his money. Did he submit it twice?
He's asking.
Yes.
He did.
He withdrew. We have that money. We didn't give that money back. Then he refiled and he paid again, but he asked for a waiver of the fees.
I think we ought to give him back. It was my opinion.
Yeah. So your opinion was everyone's opinion was it was for all the fees.
Right.
Both state and bylaw fees
right.
are going back.
Right.
That's all I needed
right.
to know.
I don't have objections. It's the same permit. We want to see this move
same
forward.
Same permit, same guy, same site, same...
Pretty much
I mean,
same
really,
element.
For us
same
to review
partner.
That next permit, it's not that different from the first permit we reviewed.
All right, so I got to that. That's
issue.
All I had to really make
okay.
sure I did.
Okay. Emergency permits? Any of those?
No.
No? Any bills?
No, I actually called MACC because last year in my calendar at this time we were approving a bill for our membership and I called them up and they said, no, we're sending it out in a couple weeks.
Oh, okay.
Imagine that. They, you know, for the first time in like 100 years, they don't send it out on that date.
Well, I know for towns, June 30th is a big...
They haven't been in existence then.
For June 30th.
Oh, I was just kind of like looking at them and deciding how long they've been there. But yeah, you're right. It's probably why you last.
But the fiscal year ends soon for the town. So. All right. So anything else?
Friends and Family Day.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's going on with that?
Yeah. What are we doing?
I can't be there early. I get a late night Friday night.
Oh, man.
But I can be there.
What time does it start?
Pretty late.
Oh, I can remember.
Nine?
Chuck, do you remember the...
Yeah, 10 to 3. 10 to 3.
It's 10 to 3.
Yeah, so I think like you got to be
there early. We have a table.
Didn't we discuss who was going to be there when at the last meeting?
No, we did not.
Oh, we
yeah,
did.
It was it was
did.
You, Jamie.
We raised our hands, but we didn't
there
set
three
no,
people.
We don't, there are three. Becky.
And Annika.
Yeah, but we didn't.
And we were all going to be
five
there.
Minutes,
but
hopefully.
We didn't say exactly
Jamie
when.
Jamie did not commit to being there.
Jamie said he would be there all day. What does it say in the minutes?
Jamie's good.
Oh, just that Brian, me, and Rebecca are going to be there at the booth. So we need to set up time slots because this is Saturday.
Right.
Yeah. So
do we have anything for our booth?
We have a
we
motorcycle.
Have a
oh, is that damaged?
It's not
doesn't
damaged.
Have any wheels on it.
It's
you,
not damaged.
We have a motorcycle to attract people.
With a bumper sticker that says save gas, ride a Harley.
Yeah, okay.
All right. Things we've
we
had in the past.
We used to have a turbo.
Yeah,
I have a bunch of
we
things to hand out that I got at the MACC conference. So you guys can sort through that and kind of put that on the table. So you'll have things to talk about. Plus I have a bunch of you know
we
when
have
I
the
go
banner.
Talk to scouts and
yeah,
whatnot.
Have
I have vernal pool stuff, and there'll be things.
We have a
all
banner.
That's taken care of.
You're taking care of the table.
Don't
the
we
tent?
Have some
that
from
has
material?
Happened. I don't know about the tent though. I'm not sure. If
we need a tent.
They supply it.
We definitely need a tent.
We need a tent.
Well,
can we use some conservation funds to
buy a tent?
Yeah.
No.
I'm 99% sure they're supplying the tents. They always have.
$100.
They always have. They've always supplied them. We got to check with John. I think John would know, right?
No, we asked for a tent and a table.
Yeah.
And so we should get it, but there's always, don't you guys afraid that you won't get it? So that's why I was wondering if someone else had it.
I'll bring the tent for more.
There you go.
Just in case.
Okay, so Brian's bringing back a tent on his motorcycle.
On my bicycle. I ride my bicycle.
Okay. Okay, so we have this. The banner. So, I mean, I've got some handouts from that I took as well from MACC. I can bring those. I'll call Will and see if he wants to bring the turtle.
The turtle would be great.
Oh,
the turtle, really?
Jeez. Oh, leave the turtle.
It's done this every year for the last
yeah, but
three,
looking
five
for
years.
I would feel horrible.
I think it can handle
if
it's
that
not a
kill the
turtle.
That turtle likes to get out occasionally.
It's not a native species. It was a pet. It's a painted turtle.
It is a native species.
Oh, I didn't
well,
think
somewhere.
It was. I thought it was something
yeah,
that
Bill
was,
said it was.
I thought it was. I thought it was just a pet store
yeah,
turtle that
no,
got released.
I don't think so.
Yeah, no, I think
what
it is.
What is it, Eastern painted?
Yeah.
I don't think Will would buy a turtle at paint store.
No, he caught it.
No, yeah, he said
it switched rivers.
He says, I found it, and it doesn't belong
it.
Where I found it.
Right,
so.
Right, so he picked it up.
Yeah, it belonged in his house.
Yeah.
Right.
It's
a draw.
Isn't it a box turtle?
No, it's a painted
turtle.
It's a
painted turtle, no.
It's a painted turtle.
Yeah. It's a box
you
turtle.
Look at all the kids.
Yeah,
absolutely.
They do.
So, Chuck, you got some wildlife samples?
Don't ask Chuck about wildlife samples.
Hey.
No, seriously. Kids like hands-on stuff, and so
skulls.
Do you have something?
Oh.
Do you have something?
Oh, that?
Yeah.
I thought we were getting some, like, you know, skin and
no,
some...
I can't get that.
Are you bringing a perennial plant?
I'll see what I can do tomorrow. I'll have to make a note
yeah,
for
I
myself.
I can bring one
or
two.
I wonder if I should go.
Just don't bring the migratory bird parts. It's going to be a lot to have one.
Just straight out.
What are you going to get? What do you want?
I would love a native, like one or two natives.
What did we get last
year?
You got
Mahoney's.
One last year.
I went to Mahoney's. I talked to them about a couple native plants that were very tolerant to
children.
Children and water and invasives
and everything. So, which is the definition of
native,
basically?
Yeah, we are. We buried
yeah.
one
so,
in the hot
tub.
So, would you look into that?
I'm sorry. What are you talking about? Do you want me to go get some plants?
He just offered.
Yeah. Well.
What do you want to get?
It's like we do a raffle. We have a couple of native plants.
They're just 6-inch pots.
And we do
that
a raffle.
Gardeners who are interested in improving their backyard, we give them a native plant that's hardy.
Do we raffle it all?
Oh,
yeah.
You know what?
I should have read this.
It's like yeah, it's
yeah.
a free raffle. Yeah.
We also did a raffle before for the Mass Audubon, but that was just because they were having a.
That's right. I remember.
We've done that before. I think a couple of plants would probably be great. You know, people are always looking for giveaways and freebies at, you know, at these tables, I think,
we
offering
rocks,
something that's appropriate.
Tape. No, we do. We need rocks and tape. Rocks
I'll take care
weights.
Of that. I'll
paper
take care
weights,
of that.
Papers
I know.
Go everywhere.
Well, we haven't figured out who's going what time.
That's even more important.
Can you go early? Because
I
say
wanna
you have
go
to drive.
To the farmer's market. It's my only weekend around.
When can you go?
I can go any time, but
between 10 and 3. I mean, if
I
can
be
take,
there early if I need to be. But
well,
you,
we
got to
be there at 9, right?
9:30, 9:45.
Chuck, the table, is it set up or do we have
no,
to?
No, it's just piled in one area, and you.
Oh, okay, fine.
It's just there's a stake that says here's your spot, your space on the
we'll
lawn, and you go
area.
And you.
All right.
We'll probably be over by Home
and,
Depot or something.
Anyway, we'll be out in the middle of the field where the sun is.
Sure.
So
last time I did
bring your
freezing.
I will try to
chair.
Show up to help you set up and stick around for a while, so that shouldn't be an issue.
Okay, so 9:45?
Yeah, whatever. I'll just take one of my
kids.
And
I'll show
and
up for the setup as well, just to drop off, because I've got a lot of supplies and stuff.
Well, do you want me to come by and get it?
Sure, if you want.
All right.
Well,
okay.
You know
9:45.
What? Can I do it Friday night?
Yeah.
Get your stuff Friday night?
I'm going to say yes, and then I'm going to go home, and I'm going to check my crazy
You can drop it off in
yeah.
town, and I'll bring it down. If you feel like
Either
you
way.
Can bring it down to town, then I'll just bring it down town day.
Bring a raincoat.
Then you can be out of it.
Is it
Sorry.
Raining Saturday?
It's supposed to. It's supposed to. Yeah. Potential rain.
Okay. So Rebecca, you can be there from 9:45. Let's see, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3.
Pretty sure all the stuff is done.
Till 11:30.
Sure.
Till 11.
12.
Till 12.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Do you want to be there from like 11:45 to 1:32?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll put you there. All right, 11:45 to 2. And I'll be there to wrap up from 1:45 to 3. Okay? Should I email this out to everybody?
Yep.
Okay.
I
Thank you.
Can you send it with a little add to my calendar link too?
I'll try.
Just give me.
Extra link. All right.
1:45 to 2 you have.
Okay, anything else?
The minutes, draft minutes.
Okay.
Yep, we have the minutes.
Okay.
I made some changes, and I think.
Yeah,
these. Yeah.
I like that way of making changes. It's just easier to incorporate.
Okay, there's some missing numbers for Howard Street on the second page. Is that you have pound symbols in there?
Yeah,
is
there wasn't on last week's last time's agenda. There was no case number for that.
Do we have it?
I don't know.
I could check. Should I check with Ann, Chuck, or something?
Well, I don't.
Yeah.
I didn't even hear it. What are we looking for? Second
page. On
page
2, the 115 to 119 Howard Street. We didn't have an.
Rolling out the rocks, pulling out the concrete wall.
We didn't have number and map number.
I
can look back.
Okay. Can track that down. Nobody here has it.
My change under Lawrence Street, which is outside the 100-foot buffer, we need to strike that because it's not outside the 100-foot buffer.
Okay.
And also, I think, didn't we ask for 3 concrete bands, one at each property line and one at the turning point on Lawrence Road?
70 Lawrence Road. Yeah, this says 3 to 4.
We did. So that's Lawrence Road. 3 go in, one at the turning point and one at each property line.
Right. wasn't there an issue at James Road where he couldn't get all the rocks in and there was a rainstorm and there was some erosion?
Yeah, James Road needs review. So this one I was checking out too. So
I have the note that Phil was to be hand dug
from
the hay bale line.
So the project was well run. So I went to the project. Michael Flynn has an audio. Went to the project. Some donated peel is used. So that doesn't need to be in there. Some donated material that needs. I mean, I did say it, but I said everything is donated out there, not some.
But the issue you brought up was that there was erosion into the wetland that
right.
they had hand dug out.
No.
Or that they were going to hand dug out.
They were going to. So there is a retaining wall, and 2/3 of the stone was all of it was donated, but only 2/3 showed up. They're waiting for this last third, but all of the fill showed up, and it's higher than the stone. And over the winter, it washed. You know, one was about 15-20 feet. But I went out there and told them about it. They instantly put up hay bales. They instantly put up erosion control, and they're going to get some. Everything's volunteer over there. So when they get some volunteer people, which was supposed to be 2 weeks ago, and I will check again, they're going to hand shovel that stuff out.
Yeah.
Okay? And Dave Petrovich from, what's the name of that place?
Didn't the Boston One fund like $20 million or $30 million? I don't understand why.
Because
he's not eligible for that.
No.
He is, and he has a separate fund and trust.
Why do we need volunteers?
Well, he's associated with the labor, not the labor union, but the contractors union or the carpenters union, and these guys have fallen over backwards to help this guy out. So that's why all those guys are showing up to help.
Right.
So there's no that's just out of their heart. So, but the point is that. They're going to take care of it. It is a well-run project. It seems to have turned around. They have a new dedicated site guy on there that stays throughout the project. But the guys that come to work only work for a week. So, and then new group comes in. This is how I've heard.
So what's your understanding about when it's going to be excavated and pulled out? It's up in the air?
No, he said he'd get on it right away.
Okay.
I've already stopped by once. It wasn't done. The guy that was there shot him, he shot him an email that wasn't very friendly, but it wasn't me. He just said, I'll get him for you.
Yeah.
And so he shot him an email. And
what do we want the minutes to say?
Okay.
I don't think we should say it's a well-run project. I mean, it doesn't sound like it's a well-run project.
I think,
yeah, there's
erosion
some stuff that
was found in the wetland. The client promised to get it hand dug out.
That's good.
That's all we care about.
You get that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Stormwater permit.
Yeah, I didn't understand that sentence.
How about just DEP had issues regarding the stormwater permit?
We were contacted by DEP. They had concerns about the accumulated effect. That's what it's supposed to say.
Okay.
And asked us to take...
Accumulated effect of what?
Of work on the bank and work underwater, land underwater work.
Accumulated effect towards the 401 water quality certificate.
Right.
Based on a permit that never expires.
Yep. Okay, you got that, Julie?
Yeah.
Okay. One general way.
Yeah, I'm
okay.
Not sure if my edits are correct now. Other property is proposing to turn Red Maple Swamp into a more open wetland. I guess
that's what was said, though, right?
Yeah.
Yep. I mean, but that's...
Okay. That's good. And then the Scotland Road, where are we on our favorite project?
The letter went out. It doesn't say that you asked me to make a map, but you did. You said draw out
yeah.
the jurisdictional areas on a map, and that
right.
was asked for.
I remember that.
Okay, I just said with any information we have
yeah.
regarding delineation.
So I got the delineation from next door, and I made a plan and put the jurisdictional setback lines on it and wrote him a letter explaining everything.
Okay.
And he actually came here and talked to me about his new project, and he was happy to find out it was in the outer portions of the buffer zone.
Okay.
We discussed whether it's going to be an above ground pool or an in ground pool, and he's going to be working on this project soon.
So it's
great.
What I've said accurate? It sounds like it is.
Except I don't think you asked me to draw the map.
I don't say map.
Yeah, I'm just reading it.
What my notes on Scotland were that
me.
Chuck
I mean,
was to send a cover letter for the former Reading Open Land Trust property wetlands map. So.
Well, we were also asking him not to do any work, asking him writing not to do any work.
Which is in
there.
He definitely has that.
Yep.
I could.
So is what I've said accurate enough? So I move we accept
good.
The minutes as amended.
I'll second. All those in favor? Okay, any other business?
We are coming up on the end of the year, so.
Yes, we are.
What, you
we,
looked into
at the
rules.
Next.
The elections are...
Jamie, you have jumped the gun.
I have talked to
her in depth about coming up tonight and mentioning this. And I'm sure it was on your list.
This is Jamie's
yeah.
thing, though.
But wait a minute. But Anika knows, and she has...
So what? Part of the town bylaws is that every board goes through an election... And ours begins to be discussed
no.
at the next. We can discuss it at the next meeting.
It has to be finalized by the end of July.
Right.
End
so
of
we
July.
Can,
yeah.
Right. So we can bring it up. Why don't we start the discussion at the next meeting? And if we get to a vote at the next meeting, we do. And if we don't, we move it to the meeting afterward.
Sounds good.
All right. Any
so
other items?
Just so you know, and I'm not part of the election, but I'm not going to be here the first for the July 4th holiday, so I'm going to miss one meeting in July, the first meeting. So I'll try.
Meetings?
I will
cancel.
Prepare everything that I can. But I typically miss that meeting for that holiday. So have fun, guys.
A lot of people are.
It'll be the 8th, I guess. July 8th.
Oh, there it is. So what are the July meeting dates?
8th and the 22nd?
So were you looking for the order of condition number for Howard Street? It's 0646.
Oh, thank you. All right.
270-0646.
Any other business? No? Motion to adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Thank you.
Oh, and our next meeting is Allison's last.
Yep. Yep.
And when's the new guy come on? Not until July, right?
No, end of this month. I think
well,
they're going to talk
with the committee
June 23rd.
On the 23rd, then the whole select.